Alright, welcome to Bevel Up. So this is that new video series I was going to do on a review of basically classwork. So what I plan to do is after class every day, I'm going to review the slides that we go over and any extra information that we get. And today is the first day and we have almost 40 slides. So pretty much we're just going to get down to it. But so today was care of preoperative patients. We're doing chapter 14 with Joni. I'm gonna splice this together with the next video that I'll record for the second day of this class, and then hopefully like anybody in class that goes back to view this, or maybe anybody who goes to view it anyway, will have like the material together. So like anything for pre-op patients I'll have together, and then afterwards I'll have our pharm class stuff together, and then possibly I'll do a clinical review when we start clinicals up, and I'll just give you guys an insight on how my clinical went and anything that I did or found out in clinical that was cool. I guess I'll also, if there's any cool medical information that I come across, I'll include that in here too. God, I got something in my eye. I'll probably have to edit this out later, but anyway, let's start up. So the preoperative period is going to start whenever the patient gets scheduled for surgery, and it ends when they get transferred to the post-op site, which is like the surgical suite. Nurse will function as an educator, advocate, promoter of health and safety, and promote patient cooperation, basically all stuff we already know. I'd really hate me by now, because I just say a lot. But there's plenty of reasons for surgery. So you can have diagnostic surgeries. So that'll be anything like laparoscopic or anything that's just going in to see what's going on. You have curative stuff, which is going to completely cure what's going on with you. And then you have restorative, which is going to improve your functional ability. So so like curative would be like appendicitis. Like you remove the problem. It's no longer there. You get rid of an appendix, you can't have appendicitis. Restorative care is like hip replacements, knee replacements, stuff like that. Things that are going to benefit your productivity and life. Palliative stuff, that's going to be like your cancer stuff when you remove tumors and like debulk them. It's anything that's going to like help with the disease, but it's not going to get rid of it. So you'll still have it. It's just going to help deal with it. And then you have cosmetic stuff like rhinoplasties and, you know, breast augmentations. So the cosmetic stuff will be anything that can alter physical appearance. We did discuss in class, I think Eric brought it up, that tattoos might be considered a cosmetic surgery, a minor one. Kind of makes sense if you think about it, because, you know, you are changing your physical appearance through injecting something into the body. So I think that's cool and something you can take into consideration. There's different classifications for surgeries. So you can do that by urgency. So you'll have like things that are like electives. So like it's non-acute, like cataracts, like, hey, I want to get this done. Let's get rid of it. I guess another thing would be back to like the cosmetic stuff. Like this is something that like you don't have to have done immediately, but like it's something that like will help you or like you want. Then you have urgent things, which are things that like need to get done, but like they can wait. So like appendicitis, bowel obstructions, like they're not killing you, but you know, you gotta get rid of it. Then you have emergent stuff, you know, like bullet wounds, hemorrhaging. One that was brought up was AAA, which is abdominal aortic aneurysm. So anything that's like life-threatening is gonna be the higher classifications there. Then you have degrees of risk, you have minor and major. So like major is like a heart transplant, that's like some serious stuff, and then minor is going to be like just like a wound. Extent, so you have simple, radical, and minimally invasive for categorization. Simple is just going to be like small removal, you know, like you're just going in getting rid of one thing, whereas like radical is like a hysterectomy or a mastectomy. Like anything that's going to go in and like, you know, evaluate the whole system that's in there and possibly, you know, get to like the lymph nodes and things that are involved. And then minimally invasive is like laparoscopic stuff. So anything involving the scope, So anxiety is like a pretty big thing, pre-op. People are going to come in, it's going to affect their vital signs, it's going to affect, how they see the surgery, and you're going to want to like try to calm them down, promote rest, use distractions, teach the family members because they're probably distracted with the anxiety and what you got going to calm them down. And you want to help encourage communication by being slow with them. Like, I'm talking really fast right now, and that's probably really bad. But, it's the first video. I'm looking around, like, I'm trying to figure out, like, how to do this. But make sure you do, like, pre-op teaching. Make sure they know what they're doing, getting into. And, like, when you take vital signs, we discussed this in class that, like, when they get there, they're gonna have anxiety. So, like, everything's going. You wanna, like, get them in there and get them relaxed and then assess your vital signs. Maybe take them 2 to 3 times. If they're starting to repeat on the serious levels, then I'd definitely be like, okay, we're gonna report this because this is serious. So, as we all know, a break in skin is a risk for infection. And a patient may be asked to like shower using antiseptic solution. Some like thing to be worried about is it could like dry their skin. Some people shower before they come in. And for like hair removal, you're not gonna want to like shave with like a razor. You're gonna want to try to stay electric, because like those nicks and cuts are gonna be open and like risk for infection with like ingrown hair and stuff. Another thing is I think it's called depilatories. Basically, Jody just said it's basically nair, like anything to like get it off that isn't gonna cause a cut, like a chemical thing, like a cream. So it's about that. So for pre-op meds, there's plenty for anxiety, relaxing, prevent laryngospasms, which is like your vocal cords closing up, and then like it prevents breathing. Very difficult scenario to work with. Vagal-induced bradycardia, gastric secretions, and things that are going to decrease anesthetic. So the main ones Joni wants us to remember are Ativan, hydroxyzine, and metoclopramide or Reglan. The Ativan is going to be used for anxiety, the hydroxyzine is going to be used for sedation, and the metoclopramide Reglan is going to be used for like decreasing stomach activity and secretions. There's a couple other ones that we can see on here. So like reducing vagal-induced bradycardia, you're going to want to try to take down their coughing and bearing down uses, and nasal and oral secretions can be reduced with anticholinergics. Okay, so assessment. You got to get an assessment, and when you do this, you want to get a full history, as much data as you can, their age, their allergies, drugs, substances. If they smoke, it's going to cause some problems. We all know that. Please stop. Anyway, so for allergies, we went over a couple of them. I'm going to read them off because they're a little bit interesting. So, if they have an egg, peanut, or soy allergy, you're going to want to avoid propofol. Shellfish, you're going to want to avoid iodine. And for latex allergies, you're going to watch for kiwi, avocado, strawberries, and bananas. Those are going to be, if they have an allergy to those things, they're going to be at risk for latex allergy. The latex allergy is going to be the most serious during the surgery because if they set up anything in the surgical room that has latex, the whole thing has to be redone. So be aware of that. Alcohol is going to decrease the anesthetic effects. So if somebody's like a heavy user or under the influence at the time, you need to be aware that their anesthetic's not going to be as effective. So you need to get that history. Smoking is going to decrease healing because of like perfusion and such. So that's good to be aware of. Some people like to receive their own blood if there's going to be blood used. I guess if they need an infusion mid-surgery, you should definitely get their blood type for that information. So you should always be doing discharge planning, and you need to know what they're going home to, who's going to be able to support them, and what kind of rehab they're going to be able to do. So make sure you got that. And then we got a few stuff that Joni wanted us to memorize, some herbs that could really mess you up. So garlic, ginger, ginkgo biloba, ginseng, and fish oil are all going to prolong bleeding time. So definitely be sure that you know their herbal substances that they're using. And there's usually like a time frame between when they can have consumed this and when they can have surgery, and you need to be aware of that. Okay, so like I said earlier, you need to get baseline vital signs, and you need to focus on the problem areas identified in the history. You should definitely go into as much detail for any system that's going to be affected by the surgery. And any abnormal stuff needs to be reported to the surgeon and the anesthesia team as soon as possible. But always do a full head-to-toe when you're doing surgical stuff, because you need to know everything that's going on, because anything and everything will affect how this happens. So a brief overview on the system assessment. So an MI within 6 months is going to be pretty serious. You should probably definitely know that. For respiratory, be aware for like barrel-chested or clubbed fingers. We know that the clubbed fingers are a sign of smoking usually, and it is decreased perfusion. And you should, for renal and urinary stuff, you should check their bun and creatine tests, or BUN, bun. And that's going to increase toxicity, possibly, with drugs. And there might be some electrolyte interferences. Also, definitely check to see if there's any signs of a UTI, because if they're going in with an infection, that's not a good start for something like surgery. Well, guys, we're moving along pretty slowly here. We're about a third of the way through, and I'm already at 12 minutes. This is going to be like an hour-long video, but it's going to help everybody out, so I'm hoping that, you know, we'll get a little bit going here. I'm really just reading slides and going into what I took from the lecture. I don't know if it's going to help more than study guide, less than study guide. I'll also put a study guide review at the end. When I finish those up. So, neurological assessment, you're going to want to compare pre-op and post-op, like how they're functioning, the way they walk, the way they think, the way they talk, anything that's going on with cognitive functions there. And for musculoskeletal, you can have issues with positioning due to arthritis. So definitely figure out what the patient's okay with and not okay with. Positioning wise, obviously for like pain, not like, oh, I don't like the way on my side, but like anything that's going to actually affect what's going on. Nutrition is definitely going to affect everything. So if they don't have a lot of protein, there's going to be a risk for infection. If they're, you know, missing other nutrients, there's going to be poor wound healing. You need to make sure that they have good nutrition. Psychosocial symptoms, you need to watch for anxiety, coping skills, support. They're going to have an altered body image, because some surgeries are going to produce large scarring. I know I have one on my left shoulder here. I'm not really worried about it. I think it's kind of cool. But some people, you know, like you might have like a C-section, you'll have a line across your stomach. And some women aren't comfortable with, you know, bikinis after that or anything like that. So you need to be aware of how that's going to affect them. And anxiety is going to definitely increase like their response to pain. So be aware that you need to try to calm them down or analyze this whole situation. This next one's a really big one with laboratory assessments. So I'm just going to take like the big ones she took with us. There's going to be other electrolyte levels I might go over in the next clip. When we go over them on Wednesday, but the main one she went over is high potassium. That's going to cancel a surgery because it's going to cause arrhythmias and make it hard for them to wake up. So you're going to need to be very vigilant for that. 2 to 3 is a therapeutic range for people on anticoagulants for INR, and 1.1 is for normal people. You need to definitely watch out for any risk for increased bleeding. Like I said, some of the electrolytes, serum creatine is going to point to kidney problems. a pregnancy test because you don't want to affect the fetus, and bad x-rays, which will usually be done prior to you getting them, and then EKGs for arrhythmias and AFib. Some patients, Joni said, don't even know that they have AFib, so probably good to get all these information. But the x-ray, pregnancy, creatine, electrolytes, and clotting factors are going to be the ones that you can cancel surgery for. A big indicator that she said for determining whether or not it's going to cancel the surgery is anything that can be fixed on the way to surgery, you're fine. If it's going to be hard to fix, or, you know, we're not going to be able to bring it down in that time frame, then you're not going to cancel it. So, or maybe I said that wrong. Fixable, we're okay. Hard to fix, we're not okay. But that's pretty much what we'll go with that. So for informed consent, I'm going to go really quick with this one. So the surgeon has to be the one that gets it. You as the nurse can witness it. If they're under 16, they need a parent or guardian with them. They can withdraw consent at any point in time. If it's an emergent situation and you can't reach family, you can't reach anybody, two physicians have to both sign off on that. In an emergent situation where telephone is used, you need two nurses and the surgeon to sign off on it. Patients can sign with an X, a heart, you know, whatever they want to sign with, as long as, you know, they're acknowledging that they've been read and understand the agreement. You as the nurse aren't responsible for any, like, detailed information. You can answer small questions, but any major questions, go get the surgeon. They have to come out. Anesthesia won't take them. Nobody else will take them if that surgeon does not come out and answer that question. So, and when they sign this, make sure that they're free of mind-altering drugs, because obviously they don't know what's going on. Okay, so when you implement dietary restrictions like MPO for surgery, so it's 6 to 8 hours, some places do 12, she said, but you need to stress the importance of this because, like, there's a risk for aspiration on, like, whatever they ate. So say we said not to eat, you eat, we come in, we do the surgery, you aspirate, and you throw up, like, a whole bowl of Cheerios, like, that's not good. So we need to be able to do that. So if you don't follow these instructions, we can definitely cancel surgery. And there's medications that you're going to have to take probably, you know, such as cardiac stuff, respiratory disease, seizures, hypertension. Because, like, if you have a seizure on the table, then we're not really getting anything done anyway. So typically a physician will sign off that you can take that medication with a sip of water and only water. But they have to sign off on that. If there's no sign off on that, then, you know, we're assuming messed up. So we'll have to cancel. So there's intestinal preparation where they have to basically clean out your colon. They can use an enema or I think they said light go, easy go. I don't know what they're talking about. I'm not that into that information, but laxatives, really, and they're going to clear you out. Nobody likes it. Doesn't taste good, but that's how it goes. So we also have patients that are at risk for VTE, which is venous thromboembolisms, blood clots, for those of you that don't understand what that is. So you're going to have obese patients, people over 40, people with cancer, decreased cardiac output, decreased mobility, so a sedentary lifestyle, if you have a history of it, varicose veins, edema, oral contraceptives, some of them, only the ones with estrogen though, and Joni said that very few use that. I was thinking myself personally that with the transgender thing, well, the transgender wave that's coming in, you know, like people are more accepting of it, and there's a lot of people going through like the treatments, which are like sometimes involving hormones, from what I understand. If you're having those estrogen injections, that's going to cause some issues. And then there's smoking, obviously. Please stop. Hip fractures and knee replacement stuff, that's going to reduce you to a sedentary style, so you need to be pretty aware of that. Stockings and compression sleeves might be uncomfortable, but you need to stress that the patient needs them for these VTEs. And you need to make sure that while they're awake, you need to increase circulation every hour, give them some exercise. And definitely don't do any leg massages, because you'll loosen up the clot. Alrighty. So for the chart review, you want to make sure that all documentation is there, it's all dated within the month, you check for surgical consent, you have their allergies, height, and weight, all lab results are in there, abnormal ones are noted, and when you do a site, three people need to mark the site. You need the surgeon, the patient, and the pre-op or circulating nurse. Later we're going to go into the circulating nurse in about like 10 slides, I think it is. Basically, it's just whoever the nurse is that oversees the operating room, usually an RN. And there's four steps to the pre-op chart thing. So you need to ID them, make sure they clear their bladder, vital signs once they hit the bed, and then administer pre-op medications. So with the vital signs, like I mentioned earlier, you want to make sure that you let them set in. So like if you take it, it's a little abnormal, come back in like 15-30 minutes, get another run. If it's still abnormal, you're going to want to report it, because there might be some underlying conditions that you need to worry about. So for patient preparation, remove the clothing down to your gown, get rid of your valuables. Normally they'll tell you not to bring them. People still bring them, but you're going to have to lock them up for them. Tape rings in place if they can't be removed. But you're going to need a consent form for that, because sometimes they're going to do cauterization and that can heat up the metal and cause some burns. So they need to be aware of that issue. Make sure the patient keeps the ID band on, because they have to be identifiable at all times. You need to remove dentures, prosthetics, hearing aids, contacts, fingernail polish, artificial nails, and jewelry. The nail stuff is so the, pulse ox can get a reading. And the jewelry, obviously, for jewelry reasons. And, you know, dentures, like imagine like you're going in to intubate somebody and then just like teeth pop out. That's not cool. So next we have how aging affects things. So obviously you're gonna have decreased cardiac output, peripheral circulation is gonna be down like smokers, vital capacity, blood oxygenation, the kidneys and the glomerular filtration rate are gonna be down. They're gonna have increased blood pressure, risk for skin damage and infection, sensory deficits, usually hearing. And there's going to be possibly osteoporosis and arthritis issues, which are going to affect positioning, like I mentioned earlier, you know, if they have any issues with positioning. And sometimes they'll have, like, neuropathy in the legs, you know, diabetics, that's a big thing there. The more comorbidities that you have, the higher your risk is. So, like, the more things you got going wrong, the worse it's looking. And the elderly are the highest post-op risk for complications. All right, so considerations for pre-op care are chronic illness, malnutrition, impaired self-care ability, inadequate support, stress, cardiopulmonary complications, mental status, and risk for falls. Obviously, for the elderly, like risk of falls is going to be a big thing, because like a hip fracture when you're that old can definitely totally put you out for the rest of your life. So you need to be very observant of whether or not like they're at risk for those types of things. All right, we got a couple questions. I don't really know how I'm gonna do these, but I think I might include them in the description. I think that's what I'll do. So I'll include these in the description, and we'll go over them. I'm going to say the answers, and then you can read them in the description and get them later. So go take them now. Come back. I'll give you the answers here in about 3 seconds. So question one, the answers are A, B, C, and D. You want to make sure that you get a recent history. You want to make sure that you communicate how they're doing, the vital signs. You want to verbally verify, hey, did you understand? Yes, I understand. And you want to make sure that you standardize the way that you hand off the information. Okay, so for question two, we threw it out. Joni said she wouldn't ask this type of question, but hemoglobin normal ranges are 12 to 16 for females, 14 to 18 for males. So this is low. So be aware of that. Serum potassium is going to be between 3.5 and 5. So 2.5 is low. Sodium is 135 to 145. So that's in range. And fasting blood glucose textbook is 60 to 100. Joni said realistically like 80 to 120 is going to be a realistic thing to look for. So two of those are within range, two are out of range, normal nursing question style. So you're down to the top two. What's more at risk? And the low potassium, like I said, is a risk for canceling surgery because you can fix it, but it's not an automatic cancellation. I think they threw out the hemoglobin because it is an automatic cancellation and the question only asks for a potential. So for those of you that are looking at this from class, Joni said to make sure that you memorize your values. So definitely check out whatever value she gives us on Wednesday that I'll probably reference in the next clip. I hope I get that information. Okay. So, question three, pre-op, what's the most important thing that's going to go down during surgery? It's kiwi allergy, because it's going to relate to latex, and latex is involved in the surgery, so that's why that'll be there. Codeine, you're going to get after surgery. The iodine for shellfish is pre-op, so not important. You'd have already messed up if you got it by then. And the sulfa drugs are usually before and after, so, or after, and or, so. Those aren't effective during. All right, so let's go to intraoperative. I'm gonna try to speed through because I'm almost at a half an hour already, and this is gonna be a really long video for those of you that really watch it. But I mean, I guess if you have the time, you can listen to me. I have an annoying voice, probably. So you could probably listen to it while you go to sleep. Probably put you out. But okay, so the members of the surgical team, you're gonna have the surgeon and their assistant. Typically, that's going to be a nurse, but like in teaching hospitals, Joni said, it'll usually be like a resident or another physician. Your anesthesia provider is going to be the CRNA, who is a clinical certified registered nurse anesthetist. So they're the ones that's going to stay in there. The anesthesiologist is going to come before and after, make sure, see you go under. So you come up, the CRNA is going to be the one in there the whole time, making sure that you stay good. The holding area nurse is the pre-op, so what we did before, that nurse. The circulating nurse, like I said, is going to oversee the whole thing. She's going to charge the operating room, and it must be an RN. She's making sure like the counts are right, you know, everybody's maintaining sterile technique, sterile field. And then you have a scrub nurse, which can be an RN, LN, or scrub tech. They pass the instruments and do the sterile setup that's overseen by the circulating tech. Then you have a surge tech. This can be also the scrub nurse. So that's a up in the air type thing. You might only have one, you might have two. So specialty nurse, typically Joni said docs will bring their own people sometimes, like a specialist in that issue. Like a cardiac person, an otolaryngologist might bring somebody that's specialist, somebody they're comfortable with and they want to have on their team. So you got to make sure that like if anything goes wrong, you need to report it. The circulator and the scrub tech are definitely going to be the people who report when an instrument count goes wrong. You're going to do that before you do the surgery, during when you make additions, the first closure you make, and then the final closure of the skin. So basically what this means is like we have 5 sponges. Okay, we got 2 more. We have 7 sponges. How many sponges do we have at the end? Because you don't want to leave anything in there. You don't want to lose anything. You know, everybody's heard like those stories. I think in Grey's Anatomy there was like a towel somebody left. But yeah. So next we have minimally invasive and robotic surgeries. So like I said, these are going to be the small ones. It's going to be like pinhole stuff. They go in, they have a laparoscopic camera, and then they'll come in with the devices, and then they'll work from there. I think I watched a hysterectomy done this way, which is really interesting. But benefits, easy recovery, less infection, less scarring. And just the main ones we're going to go over are cholecystectomy, joint surgery, cardiac surgery, splenectomy, and a spinal surgery. Those are some things that they can go over. Those aren't all of them, but those are some of them. All right, so potential injuries you need to watch out for are mechanical traumas, so like small lacerations of the devices as they're going in. Post-op preferred pain for this is going to be, like, because they inject gas into your abdomen to inflate it when they work on your abdomen. If they don't, like, remove all of that, you'll have post-op pain radiating in your shoulders or just one of them, and that's because of the pressure on the mesentery nerve. She didn't go into thermal injury, but it's on there. I'm assuming, like, stick something hot in there and get minor burns. But I don't know because we didn't go in depth. So I couldn't tell you. I'd have to read the book, but probably not going to do that. So the environment of the operating room is for team safety. You got to maintain team safety. So for the surgeon, the team, and the patient, all of those safety has to be incorporated. Jenny said the layout for a surgical room is basically the same between all surgeries. You shouldn't be in there if you have an open wound or a cold. Surgical attire and scrubs are usually utilized. No jewelry. Joni told a story of one of her doctors lost an earring during surgery. So definitely watch out for that stuff. So you got to watch out. You're a source of bacteria. You need to maintain standards while you're in there and watch for infections and any sources of pathogens. So normally what they'll do is you'll hat and mask as a surgeon, or going in there, you'll hat and mask, you'll surgical scrub, which is 3 to 5 minutes based on what you're using. You want to keep waist to shoulder square. This is the only, this is the sterile square, basically, waist to shoulders. So they have their own technique for scrubbing in on that, and it's going to be different from each type. You basically just want to get really, really rough friction from fingertips to elbow. Okay, so you're also going to have a surgical timeout procedure, which is where everybody will get quiet, and I believe it's the circulating nurse is going to read the consent, and everybody's going to verify that, you know, this is the right patient, the right procedure, and we're on the right site, and then this information is going to be documented that it was done. So if you mess up, they're going to know that, hey, you guys were supposed to do this, so either you lied about doing it, or you guys are just dumb. So anesthesia is going to be responsible for intake and output, cardiopulmonary function, levels of anesthesia, and the vital signs. They're going to monitor all that stuff throughout the entire thing. And just for those of us that need a refresher on what anesthesia is, it's a state of partial or total loss of sensation, and it can occur with or without loss of consciousness. Moving on. Look at that, guys. I think we only have 4 more left. Pretty good. I'm already on 35 minutes. So general anesthesia is like what we all think of, like you're going under. So that's usually going to be used for head, neck, upper torso, and abdomen surgeries. It's reversible loss of consciousness, affects the CNS mainly, can be a single agent, a combination of agents, and it can be administered via inhalation, IV injection, or I think the other one's called balanced, but basically it's just combination anesthesia. It results in analgesia, so pain relief, amnesia, unconsciousness, and loss of muscle tone and reflexes. Complications, so things the CRNA and the circulator are going to have to be looking out for, are malignant hyperthermia, overdose, unrecognized hypoventilation, problems with anesthetic agents, and intubation problems. So minor complications, you have a sore throat. Okay, not too bad. Major, you die or you're in a coma. So definitely some things you need to watch out for. Finally, we're going to go on to malignant hypothermia. That's the last thing we went over for today. It's a life-threatening complication. It could be genetic. If anyone in your family has it, you need to watch out. It's going to cause poor thermal regulation once any skeletal muscle is exposed to this agent. Increased metabolism, calcium levels in muscle cells, leads to acidosis, high temperatures, and dysrhythmias. So, raises the potassium in that system. I think she said normally it's sevoflurane, which is an inhaled gas. If there is somebody that's at risk for this, you want to make them the first case of the day so that it's when the pre-op room is totally, like, cleared and run through and made sure that, like, that hasn't been used in that operating room yet today. Clinical manifestations are going to be tachycardia with low BP, skin modding, which is going to look like really blotchy skin. For those of you in class, it looks like Eric's arm roasting you, buddy. It's going to be accompanied by sweating, cyanosis, myoglobinuria, which is going to make your pee look like tea or Coca-Cola. You're also going to have a decreased urine output, so it's caused by a muscle protein that's excreted in the urine. There's going to be a rise in end-tidal CO2. The CRNA should be monitoring that. And there's going to be an elevated temperature. If you catch the elevated temperature, it's probably a really late sign. You need to really get on that. There's going to be muscle rigidity in the jaw and upper chest. And the reverse is dantrolene sodium. And it's a skeletal muscle relaxant. So definitely watch out for that, guys, and I guess I'll catch you tomorrow for the next part. All right, guys, so now we're on to day three. This is the second part of the med-surg course. So we're going to go on starting at the local anesthesia slide is where we started today. So local anesthesia is just going to be like anesthesia that's in the location and it's just for that area. It can be delivered topically or by local infiltration. So kind of like a dentist will go in and they just inject and then it's just numb this part of your jaw or like they numb a part of your skin for an injection site, as you'll see later for the epidural. Hey, bud. But anyway, so you're going to remain conscious and you're able to follow instructions when you're under this type of anesthesia. Your gag and cough reflex are intact, so you maintain an open airway. So regional anesthesia is going to block multiple peripheral nerves. So like you'll have a cervical plexus here in the neck, and then further towards the base of the neck is your brachial plexus. And then you have like your intercostal nerves, and then you have the radial nerve, the medial nerve, and then the ulnar nerves over here for like parts of your arm and stuff that they can go in and work on. So basically these are just going to be able to like block a field, a nerve, spinals, epidurals, you know, certain types of anesthesia that are only going to affect certain areas. Like we went over earlier, general is just going to put you right under, local is just going to be localized anesthetics, obviously. Hey, bud. Okay, yeah, we can hold hands. That's fine. Sorry, Binx is here. So the difference between spinal and an epidural anesthesia, spinal is going to go right into the cerebral spinal fluid, whereas the epidural anesthesia is going to go, I have a tube that goes into the epidural space. I do believe that Joni said that you're going to have to provide like, you're gonna have to help manage the pain when this happens because these types of anesthetic are gonna cause a lot of pain. And you should always be managing pain with your patients. It's one of the top things. Hi, bud. So
She said you're going to use a local anesthetic first on that area of the skin before you go in for the major injection. So you as the RN, your main thing is going to be to assist the provider, maintain the sterile technique, be emotional support because of the pain. Like I said, you're going to constantly do vital signs and repositioning for safety. Then you're going to go to the complications that can come with local or regional anesthetics. Anaphylaxis, as you know, like most things, like you should always be ready for an allergic reaction for any kind of medication that's going on. Incorrect delivery technique is another thing that you got to watch out for. So when you're doing an epidural, you could accidentally breach the cerebral spinal fluid, and that becomes more serious, and you can stop their breathing doing that. Systemic absorption, it could get too absorbed into the bloodstream, and that can cause them to go into shock, lower their blood pressure. Definitely something to watch out for. Overdose, any type of medication, you need to be aware that there is a limit of how much can go in before they start to get toxic. And then there's local complications, which, you know, we should all be ready that, like, you can get an infection from an injection site. So definitely be aware of those things when she goes into them. I also have the study guide, which I will be going over with you guys later. After this video, I'm probably gonna take a quick break, finish eating my vegetables that I cooked up, and then I'll add in the last part when I fill out the study guide. So your treatments for the complications, basically just maintain that airway, give them oxygen, notify the surgeon that there is a complication. Usually they'll use a fast-acting barbiturate as the treatment. Epinephrine for unexplained bradycardia. So those are some things you need to be aware of that can be treatments for complications. Going on to moderate sedation. So moderate sedation is just basically another word for like conscious sedation. I'll read you the definition here real quick. So IV delivery of sedation, hypnotic, opioid drugs to reduce level of consciousness. The patient maintains a patent airway and can respond to verbal commands, and it's very short. So when you go under this type of moderate sedation, you're going to be able to respond and understand what's being asked of you. Joni said that they call it snowing them. Basically, it's just a light sedation. It's very short, and it's about all we got on that. So, back to in the last part of this video, I was talking about members of the surgical team, and we mentioned a circulating nurse who's going to be in charge of, you know, the operating room, safety, making sure that everything's done right and the sterile field's maintained. Another thing that position is in charge of is common surgical positions and making sure that the position is safe. So we're going to go over a couple. So there's six of them on here. I'm going to focus on the main one that we focused on in class last, so that I can get the most information that we were given. So there's supine, as we all know, is laying flat. So you're like this, best way to do that. Trendelenburg, you know, you're lifted, feet to the sky. You have jackknife. So in jackknife, you're basically like bent over the table, kind of like, I don't even know how to demonstrate. I guess I'll just hold it up. So jackknife's going to be right here. And then you're going to have prone. Anybody that plays like Call of Duty or anything, you're going to know what prone is. Then you have lateral, basically on your side. And I'm always mispronouncing this one. Lithotomy, I think is what it's called. That one is the one we went over. It's mainly for like OBGYN stuff and rectal exams. Now, you need to watch out when you have somebody like that with their legs up in the air for so long. That circulation is going to be reduced, the blood flow is going to be down, and you're going to want to make sure that you lower both legs at the same time and slowly. Because if you don't, you could send them into shock, and that's going to be a big issue. Things you need to consider when selecting a position are age, weight, any disabilities, like we said, rheumatoid arthritis or joint pain, I guess, fractured hips, stuff like that, things that you can't be placed in that position and on that bearing that weight there. So consider those things when you're going in. You need to consider IV lines. The main thing is, can the patient breathe? Because if they can't breathe, then they're not going to be able to maintain that. Another thing that you want to watch out for is make sure that they're comfortable in that position, because for the longer surgeries, they're going to be in that position for a while, and that can cause some serious joint pain and discomfort. And going in, you want to reduce as much of the pain as possible. Another thing Joni said is a lot of physicians are going to have like what she called like recipe cards, and they're going to tell you like how they want everything set up, like what materials they want, how they want everybody positioned, the type of people they want in the room and stuff like that. So definitely keep all of these things into consideration when you're taking care of your patients. So another thing the circulator is for safety. The main thing they're there for is safety. So there's always a potential for injury, and you need to make sure that you use the appropriate interventions. So proper body positioning, prevent pressure ulcer formation, because you can develop one in surgery. So say you're going for a surgery where you know that they're going to be under for a while, you might want to like prep that, the bony prominences, so that they don't gain those ulcers over time, because they're not exactly going to be able to rotate them while they're working. So you need to be able to prep so that they're less conducive to forming. You need to prevent obstructions from circulation, respiration, and nerves. As we all know, anytime like you're cutting somebody open or the skin's broken, because the skin is your first line of defense, there is going to be a risk for infection, so you need to watch out for that. Usually infections will occur within 3 days of surgery if you're going to get one. People that are at high risk are old people, diabetics, immunosuppressed, children, people with kidney disease, and some interventions that you can do: a plastic adhesive drape, skin closure, suture staples, you know, closing up the wounds, insertions of drains, because like if that blood stays built up in that area, it's going to definitely lead to a conducive environment for an infection, and you don't want that. Proper application of a dressing, so sterile dressing. You want to keep the wound clean and sterile for as long as possible. Later we'll talk about how the surgeon's going to apply the first sterile dressing, and they will remove that first. Joni emphasized earlier on in one of our earlier classes that surgeons are very adamant about being the first remover of their dressing. And when you transfer a patient from the table or stretcher, you want to make sure that you're very gentle and using the proper technique and utilities that you have available to you, so that you don't make some scrapes across their back or any other damage to that skin that you don't want. There's also skin preps, different skin preps to reduce infection. I can't remember all the ones she listed off, but everybody knows, like, you go in for surgery, they coat you up iodine or whatever solution that they want to use, and that's to help with that. You want to minimize the traffic into the surgical room. Less people, less germs. Everybody's covered in germs. Everybody brings their own sickness. So reducing the amount of people that are in that area reduces the odds of an accident occurring like that. Sometimes they'll do antibiotic prophylaxis. So they'll use IV to inject antibiotics during surgery to constantly be preventing that infection. There's some common skin closures. I don't think she's going to want us to know the six that she does have on here. She named three because we're not exactly going to be doing them. You know, there's spaced ones, there's continuous sutures, there's staples, There's reinforced ones. Sometimes I just use adhesive tape. That's just a general rundown, but they're all just to hold the edges and prevent contamination. Typically, the blood vessels will be occluded. They'll probably, you know, solder them up when they close up that wound. So the three types that she wanted us to remember for the class was absorbable, non-absorbable, and retention. So absorbable are just biodegradable stitches, things that you're going to leave in. You're killing me, kid. Things that can stay in and your body will just digest them and you don't have to get them removed. Non-absorbable are going to be like your silk types that are going to be staying there until they are removed. And she said there are some types that they just don't get removed for certain internal suturing. Unless they go back in, they're not going to remove those. And then retention are like reinforced stitches, really. She said it's common for abdominal surgery in obese patients so that, you know, it can reinforce that tension that's going to be coming with that extra weight and stretching. Okay, so there's always a potential for hyperventilation, so you need to continuously monitor breathing, circulation, cardiac rhythms, blood pressure and heart rate, your pulse ox, your ECGs constantly going. You're going to want to be getting your blood pressures and your heart rates every 5 minutes, 5 minutes on the blood pressure and the heart rate. And there's a continuous presence of the anesthesia provider. So typically that's going to be a CRNA, as we talked about in the surgical portion of this review. The anesthesiologist is going to come in for setup and putting them under, and then they're going to come back at the end when you're waking them up. And the CRNA is going to be the one that stays. So the circulator and the anesthesia provider or team are going to be definitely in charge of preventing injury due to this. Due to the anesthetics from hyperventilation. All right, so now we're on to the questions. Be ready, guys. So I'll give you the 3 seconds, get ready, pause, and the questions will be below for you to look at. Okay, so question one, C, a decreased level of consciousness, yet able to respond to verbal commands. Like I said earlier, moderate sedation, you're able to respond, and it's just partial. Question two, during a surgical procedure, you notice that the sponge count is incorrect. What, one sponge is missing, what is the priority? Stop. You have to communicate everything that's going on. So if the count's off, that means we have to find it. So the procedure needs to stop. You need to notify the surgeon, and the whole team needs to be aware that there is something missing. Okay, so that's A. Question three, diabetes is the main one. This is one of those more correct type answers. So while we have gone over that older people are more prone to infections, the surgical drain is gonna prevent the infection. So surgical drain is good. Older people, yeah, they're more susceptible, but they're more susceptible because they typically come with chronic illnesses and the reduced skin protection. But the diabetes is actually a strong factor in whether or not you can develop an infection. So you need to be aware that that's a serious condition for that. Now we're moving on to post-op. So post-op is basically completion of surgery, transfer to PACU or ICU, ambulatory care, wherever they're going. You got to watch airway, vitals, any changes that are happening. Stay with them. In post-op settings, the recommended thing is 1 to 2 nurses. Joni said you will never have more than 2. If it's a serious patient, you will only have 1. Very one-on-one. They're open room setups, basically just curtains separating you so that the charge and the anesthesiologist can see everything that's going on. There's ongoing evaluation and stabilization of patients in this area. You got to prevent, anticipate, and manage all the complications that could be coming. So there's going to be a verbal handoff between the circulator and the PACU nurse. So this is going to be a verbal handoff. It's going to be one-on-one. There's going to be, has to be no distractions, allow time for questions, very detailed. And in some facilities, they will require you to repeat back all the information that you have now received to confirm understanding. So the PACU nurse, this is skilled in the care of patients with multiple medical and surgical issues. You have to have in-depth knowledge of anatomy and physiology, anesthetic agents, pharmacology, pain management, extubation, or tube removal for airways. So when you remove tubes from the airway. You have to have ACLS, and if you're working with peds, you need to have your PAL certification. You have to be able to make a quick decision. You're working very closely with an anesthesiologist and a surgeon. So now we're going to move on to the respiratory system assessment. This is going to be the first assessment you want to do. If their respirations are below 10, then you're in respiratory depression or hypoxia. Okay. Now that's going to be fast or shallow. Breathing is going to be a sign that they may have hypoxia, going into shock, pain, things like that. So you want to assess for a patent airway, gas exchange, any artificial airway they may have, the rate, pattern, and depth, breath sounds, accessory muscles, snoring, and stridor. Stridor is going to be that high-pitched breathing sound. That's an emergency situation if you hear stridor, whatever it's going to be going on. The respiratory depression is potentially going to be anesthesia-induced, so definitely be aware for that. Obese, diabetics, COPD, smokers, and the elderly are going to be the patients that are going to be at risk for these things. The elderly may have respiratory depression because they're slower to awaken from the anesthesia, so definitely be aware of that. Okay. Cardiovascular assessment, you need vital signs every 15 minutes. Heart sounds, cardiac monitoring, you need the blood pressure, the telemetry, and pulse ox constantly running. Peripheral vascular assessment, what are their pulses, what are their cap refill rates. You need to monitor for VTE. What's the color, is there any edema, does it feel cold? If their blood pressure and their pulse go down, you're in cardiac depression, you need to be very aware of what's going on. You could have a fluid deficit, you could be bleeding. For tachy, they could have pain, shock, or a hemorrhage. And for bradycardia, they may just be cold because, let's be honest, anybody who's been in a hospital, it gets pretty cold in there. Next, you're going to go on to your neurological assessment. So you want to check for cerebral functioning. So the main thing you're going to be looking for is altered mental status. That's going to be your first sign. Any change in consciousness, what's going on with them mentally. You need to do a motor and sensory assessment after an epidural or spinal anesthesia. You're working close with the spine and those important nerves back there, so you definitely could cause an issue if you have one of those problems, and like you could end up like paralyzing somebody or causing nerve damage, so you need to be very cautious of what's going on or what's happening. Be aware for lethargy, restlessness, irritability. Those are signs of pain and hypoxia. Another sign of pain, possibly in the elderly, is they can get confused. So confusion may actually just be a sign of pain. So fluid, electrolyte, and acid-base balance. there's probably going to be a deficit somewhere because we have had them on no eating for 6 to 8 hours, 12 hours, whatever prior to surgery that they were required. So there's going to be some deficits, and you're going to have to be aware of that. So we were told that motion sickness is possibly pre-treated because like there's going to be some nausea and vomiting when you come out. You got to make sure that you're monitoring the intake and output, what's their hydration, check their turgor, their urine, their mucous membranes, what's going on, how's their urine output, are they moist, pink, is the skin turgor good, what IV fluids are coming. Those are your ins. Are they vomiting? That's some outputs. Urine. You may have to do a bladder scan. There could be increased retention. Your bladder takes a while to wake up after this, so it may just be stopped. Wound drainage. You can measure that. That's an output. You need to keep track of that. The NG tube drainage. That's an output. You need to keep track of that. And you need to maintain that acid-base balance. So renal and urinary system is next. Check for urinary retention. That's what I was saying about the bladder scans. Because your urinary tract and your GI tract may take a while to wake back up after that anesthetic. So like the first sign of your bowel starting to move is flatus or could be stool. And for the urinary thing, you need to be aware that it could take a while. So consider all sources of output. Are they sweating? Are they vomiting? Are they diarrhea? If your urine output is less than 30 mils every hour, you need to report that. Now we're onto the GI system. I kind of gave you a thing, really, that it's common, and it could be delayed 24 hours. Here it is. Peristalsis may be delayed for 24 hours due to the anesthetic. 30% of patients are going to experience that nausea and vomiting I was telling you about, and you do treat that, and there's a few medications, Zofran, Meclizine, Anavertin, Dramamine, or a scopolamine patch. Like I said, first sign that it's waking up is going to be passing gas. And before you listen to bowel sounds, if they have like an NG tube or something suctioning going on down there, you're going to want to make sure you turn that off, because that can simulate those sounds, and you don't want to mistake that. So NG tube drainage, like I said, is an output. There will be an order for continuous or intermittent by the physician. It's hopefully inserted during surgery so that they don't have to go through that while they're awake. Decompress stomach, promote GI rest, allow lower GI tract to heal, provide enteral feeding route, monitor any gastric bleeding, prevent intestinal obstruction, and assess drain material every 8 hours. If there's blood, you're going to be doing that more often, but typical drainage, you're just going to be assessing every 8 hours. So when you check the NG tube, it should be color of like snot. It should be like boogery, like a yellowish green. That's going to be normal. If it's red, obviously that's blood. And if it's brownish, that's going to be like some old blood going on. So you need to note that, the consistency, the amount, what's going on down there. Normal wound healing for your skin assessment can take up to 2 years. Impaired wound healing or dehiscence or evisceration is going to occur within 5 to 10 days usually, and the infections within 3 days. So for an infection, you're going to be wanting to look for temperature, their temperature, warmth of the area, tender area, any drainage, the smell. That's going to happen usually within 3 days of surgery. The dehiscence is a major priority, because that's when the surgical suture or layers of skin are starting to peel apart now, so they're not staying together. This is a priority intervention, because this can lead to evisceration. So between the two, the dehiscence is more important, because it's going to lead to the other one. The other one is already bad. Evisceration is like an organ is now seeping out of that wound. So be aware of that. And you're always going to want to splint an abdomen for any like dressings that's going on down there. You're going to want to splint. So you're going to want to address pain prior to the surgery, because we all know that pain is coming. So the patient needs to be prepared for that. We're not going to be able to, you know, completely eliminate your pain, but we want to manage it. You need to let us know if as soon as you get to a 3, that's when we need to start getting you medication, because it's easier to control something before it gets out of hand than to reel something like that back in. I went over irritable, restless, tacky, confusion in the elderly. There's going to be some signs of pain. If you're conscious, we'll use a 1 to 10 scale. Note on the 3s. For children, we're going to use faces. For those people that can't communicate, we'll either use signs that we can see or the faces for them to communicate that way. You need to assess for what type of medication they're going to need based on the type of surgery, the extent, and the length of the surgery. The second day after surgery is going to be the worst for their pain because the anesthesia is just worn off and now everything's coming right at you fast. That's when they'll probably spike, and you want to catch them as soon as they hit a 3 so you can get that pain under control early. Physical and emotional signs of acute pain. Restlessness can be a sign of decreased oxygen. Increased pulse and blood pressure signs. Increased respiratory rate, profuse sweating, restlessness, confusion in older adults, wincing, moaning, crying, and an increased respiratory rate can be signs of acute pain. There's always a potential for hypoxia. The highest incidence is going to occur on the post-operative day. Like I said, that's when your pain is going to be your highest. And when you have a lot of pain, you're not really focusing on your breathing. You're not taking in enough oxygen. You're more focused on that pain and what's going on with you. So that's when hypoxia is going to be a really big issue. Basically, for that, you just want to maintain your airway, your OSATs. Semi-Fowler's position and turning are going to be your best friends. Semi-Fowler's, because it opens up that airway. And turn, cough, deep breathe. That's a method we learn in fundamentals. So what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to mobilize any of that, any of those secretions, so that it doesn't like build up and really create a blockage. You can do oxygen screening and breathing exercises. There's a spirometer for those of you that don't know how a spirometer works. So you'll take the spirometer, and what you're going to want to have them do is first take a deep breath, exhale it all out, and then you're going to suck in the air through the spirometer, and that's going to raise the ball, and you want to hit the mark or maintain an area, and we're going to mark that and keep track of where you get there. And another way to prevent hypoxia is going to be getting some mobilization as soon as possible. Increase circulation, increase your breathing, like let's get going back to normal. Potential for wound infection and delayed healing. First dressing done by the surgeon. Drains provide the exit routes. Interventions for these are going to be drug therapy, irrigation, debridement, which is going to be removal of the bad tissue from there. Surgical management may be needed to open the wound for healing. Pain interventions, there's going to be PCA. This can be basal or intermittent. PCA is just patient-controlled analgesia. But for the morphine, you're going to want to watch for any decrease in respirations. And you're going to want to look for alternative therapies as well, because focusing on just the medication can get out of hand. Like I said, the morphine can decrease your respirations. So you're going to want to help with like positioning, massaging, relaxing, and any kind of diversion techniques you can to help deal with the pain. Community-based care, Joni Strait skipped over it. She's like, I'm not really worried about it. But home care management, teaching for self-management, and healthcare resources. So this is just another patient education. Make sure, you know, they know what to do at home. They know how to take care of themselves, and they know what resources they can access. We're going on to another 3 questions, so go ahead and prepare for those. I'll give you 3 seconds. Go ahead and get ready for that, guys. You can pause. All right. Question 1. Like I said, first sign of the GI. Oh, that's some spicy celery. Anyway, first sign of the GI tract is going to be flatus. And if they're pooping, they're definitely got that GI tract going. So question 2. Priority nursing assessment, airway. ABCs, airway. Already there? Airway breathing and circulation, so you need to watch for those things. Question 3, when positioning. Now that's your key word for this question, so it's during the positioning. So D is already eliminated because D is letting them get out of bed. This is no longer a positioning thing. But the big issue that could come with pain is a pressure ulcer. And that's going to cause severe pain and some serious issues coming up. So you're going to want to make sure you reposition them every 2 hours, let them get moving, increase circulation, and decrease any wounds that could be forming due to that. Okay. Assessment of the respiratory system. So Joni just jumped over this. This is basically a quick anatomy review, so I'm going to run through it really quick, you know. Nothing super intense. Anybody that's in class has these slides, and anybody that's just watching this, it's just basic respiratory anatomy and physiology. So you have an upper and a lower respiratory tract, you have your lungs, accessory muscles. We all know hemoglobin is what transports the oxygen through your blood. So you're gonna intake, it's gonna go to the heart and then to the blood vessels through the red blood cells. You're gonna wanna know patient history, like do they have any history of COPD in their family, like do they smoke, how many packs. Packs are years, so a pack a day is 1 year, I think you multiply them. I'm not sure, so don't quote me on this, guys, but I think it's like a pack a day for 2 years is two. 2 years, and then like if you do two packs a day for 2 years, it's like 4 years, or something like that. Don't quote me, you can Google that one. If I remember it, I will post it in the below in the description, but I'm not positive that I'll get to that. Any drug use, illicit or prescribed, that can affect breathing, allergies, have you been anywhere, what's your nutritional status. You're gonna want to assess any deformities or things that can be going on. We know like cleft palates are gonna mess up here due to their surgeries. Are there any swelling, any draining, sinusitis? Is there any problems with the abnormalities in the mucus? Is there some septal deviation? You're gonna want to assess the throat, the pharynx, trachea, and larynx, the mouth. Yet again, you're just making sure that they're getting an appropriate airway going on here. You want to inspect the thorax while the patient is sitting up. Observe the chest. Compare one side to the other. Is it even? Work with the apex and work downward towards the base from side to side. Note your rates, your rhythms, and your depths, and symmetry of chest movement. So, like, say one lung is filling more than the other, you're gonna be able to see that difference in the chest wall being pushed. So abnormal sounds, crackles, wheezes, ronchi, pleural friction rub is going to be a scratchy grating sound. Other indicators of respiratory inadequacy, a big sign of an issue in peripheral diffusion is going to be clubbing of the fingers. For those of you that don't know what it is, you've probably seen your grandparents have it, if they were heavy smokers, like mine. And like, instead of coming out from your finger and then going into a divot into your fingernail, it kind of just clubs down. You'll know what it is. Some weight loss can be an indicator. Unevenly developed muscles, skin and mucous membrane changes, and activity intolerance. Psychosocial, so you're going to want to like check, is stress worsening this, is it affecting social isolation, what are your coping mechanisms, how are you doing this. Some things we're going to want to focus here on are some lab tests. Joni came back in for this, she wanted to focus on the lab tests. You're going to want to get sputum cultures, like I mentioned earlier, from like deep, so you want to get that coughing, not like a spit, like an actual hacking of something up. Standard chest x-rays, digital chest radiography and CTs. You want to do back to front and left lateral. Pulse ox is a non-invasive way to get a lab test done. So non-invasive pulmonary function testing, you want to evaluate lung volumes and capacities, flow rates, diffusion, gas exchange, airway resistance, distribution of ventilation. You can do breathing exercises to do this. Their skin testing is another non-invasive testing you can do, TB, viruses, or fungus. I think for TB, she mentioned the positive test for TB, you just need to remember 10. I don't know if that's 10 centimeters, but basically we all know that if you have a positive TB test, there's going to be a big bulge there. So definitely look out for. And you're going to want to test for any things that could cause respiratory disorders. There's a VQ scan, which is a ventilation and perfusion scan. It's going to show the lung inflation areas. Now, what I mean by that is it's going to show, say, it's going to highlight certain areas of the lungs, like this part of the lung down here is filling up too much, this part's not filling up enough, here the perfusion's good, so it's got good inflation, and it's going to tell you where the issues are and the types of issues that you're having there. Some invasive diagnostic tests that you're going to want to look out for, so you got bronchoscopy. It's going to be the insertion of a tube into your airway structures to obtain samples or biopsies. It's usually done under general anesthesia or in the ICU. NPO, so no food by mouth, 48 hours before to reduce your aspiration risk. You don't want to choke and die. Benzos before for light sedation and amnesia. After, you want to assess for risk of bleeding, infection, or hypoxia. Now, you know, you just had some stuff down your throat, so like there might be a little bit of blood. So a little bit's okay. You know, if you're coughing up a little bit of blood, you know, that might be common. But if you start seeing some ketchup consistency stuff, that's when we're really in some issues. So definitely check that out. So you also have pulmonary angiography. Now, what they're going to do for this is they're going to inject a dye into you for the test. I'm not really sure how that exactly works, but Joni said the main thing you need to know is for pulmonary angiography, they're going to inject a dye, and it utilizes a dye, and afterwards you're going to want to put pressure and apply that to the injection site. Thoracentesis is aspiration of pleural fluid or air from the pleural space. So when they do this, I'm going to try to do my best simulation of the positioning that they're going to have to be in. So they're going to have to be in a sitting position, basically, and they're going to want to lean over a bedside table like so. Okay, so it's going to be opening their back like this. Okay, I'm a little cocked, so you're not going to really be able to see it, but they're going to have this slant in their back, you know, hunched over the table. You, as the nurse, are going to be in front of them. You know, you're going to maintain the process through this. They might need some help with the pain management and coping. There's going to be a stinging sensation, feeling of pressure. They need to be in the correct positioning. They need to stay motionless, and you need to follow up with an assessment for any complications. Infection is a risk when you're doing this type of penetrative thing into the lungs. Pneumothorax, a collapsed lung, is going to be an issue. You need to watch for hypoxia. Note, if you're seeing cyanosis, it's definitely a late sign of that hypoxia, so you need to be definitely aware. And if they have immediate tachycardia, you need to be immediately reacting and trying to cope with the issue here. So the final slide here is a lung biopsy, which is an invasive procedure. They're going to go in and they're going to remove some tissue to process that sample. Okay. Follow-up care, you're going to want to assess vital signs, breath sounds every 4 hours for 24 hours. Respiratory distress, assess for that. Reduced and absent breath sounds need to be reported immediately, and you need to monitor for hemoptysis, so any bloody sputum. So that's about all we have on the lecture side of day three. There are these lab assessments and the values that I promised that I would go over with you guys. So I'll go over those really quick. And the next part of the video that you'll be evaluating will be a study guide. I'm gonna get that up as soon as I can. So let's go over lab assessment. So You need to analyze electrolytes to maintain body balance. CBC, so your blood count. There's going to be a thing called left shift or bandemia. And when you do this test, you'll see bands on the CBC count. I think she said it's usually like two or three groups of threes is what they'll come in. But you'll see two or three of these groups, and they're in bands of threes. What they are is, so your white blood cells are coming out, but they're coming out fast. So the immature white blood cells are now attacking. So now you have white blood cells that are not prepared and don't have the experience to go through this, and that's causing this left shift or bandemia. Specimens that you'll use for your culture and sensitivity test, your CNS, are going to be blood, urine, wound cultures, and sputum. Your ABGs, you're going to want to check for any imbalances. Urine and renal lab tests, you're going to want to utilize for kidney and liver functions. Procedure-specific labs, you're going to want to do glucose for diabetics. She said it's not really done. Serum amylase for pancreatic surgery or gallbladder. I put BS, probably bloody sputum. So, oh, no. Steroids can raise blood sugar. So be aware of that. All right, changes in electrolytes after surgery. I'm just going to go over the normal values. You can look up the actual use of these things. Maybe I'll give you a little quick overview. So sodium works with water to maintain proper fluid in the body. You want to stay 136 to 145 for your proper levels. Potassium is vital to heart function and muscle contraction. You want to stay between 3.5 and 5. Magnesium is vital for metabolism and function of the organs and neuromuscular tissues. You want to stay between 1.3 and 2.1. Calcium helps with nerve impulses, cardiac function, blood clotting, teeth and bone, and muscle contractions. You want to stay between 8.5 and 10.2. Phosphate helps with muscle function and red blood cells. You want to stay between 3 and 4.5. So for your CBCs, white blood count, between 4.5 and 11. Red blood count for men, 4.5 to 5.5. Women is 4 to 5. So just add a 0.5 for men, but it's 4 to 5. Your HGB, you're going to want to stay 14 to 17.4 for men, 12 to 16 for females. Your HCT, you're going to stay 42 to 52 for men, 36 to 46 for women, okay? MCV, 80 to 100. MCH, 28 to 34. MCHC, 32 to 36. RDW, 12 to 14.6. PLT, 150 to 450. MPV, 6.8 to 10.2. Normal values for pH, 735 to 745. CO2 is 35 to 45. O2, 80 to 100. HCO3, 22 to 26. Oxygen saturations, 95 to 100%. Okay, so that's that. And if I remember, I will put the regulars also in the description. Alright guys, so this time we're going to go into the study guide for our nursing care of the client 2 or MedSurg. We have a study guide worksheet kind of thing that we were given for the exam, basically just to highlight some things that we went over earlier in these slides that I read off to you guys and talked to you about the little extra stuff. So I've went through and I've gathered just about all the information that I think I need to include. There might be a little bit more that my classmates may find later that I'll utilize, but this is my version of the study guide that I'm going to be giving. So for a bronchoscopy or a biopsy, you need to know for the bronchoscopy that it's a tube insertion into the airways. The biopsy is a culture. Typically, that you're going to be under general anesthesia or in the ICU. NPO, 4 to 8 hours prior to these. Typically, they'll use benzos for some sedation. Always watch out for some bleeding. With the biopsy, you're going to want to take vital signs every 4 hours for the first 24 hours. For both of them, monitor for respiratory distress, and for the biopsy, you want to monitor the breath sounds. Okay, so next one I'm going to go into is pulmonoangiography. As I said earlier in the video when I did the day three review, basically we just need to know that you injected dye. And then afterwards, you need to apply pressure to the site. Conscious sedation is a type of sedation where they can still follow verbal orders. It's also called moderate sedation. It's a very short duration. I think the term Joni used was to snow them. Also, it's going to be IV delivery. Then we have a VQ SAN. As I mentioned earlier in the day three video, I believe it was, it's to assess lung inflation. So you'll get registration that, okay, here in this lobe, you're getting regular inflation, but in this lobe, you're getting decreased inflation. And in this lobe, you're getting increased inflation. And those are some things that you need to watch out for with those. The Mantoux test, or the TB test. Joni said to remember 10. I don't know if that's 10 millimeters or what's going on with that for raised, but basically you're just gonna note that there's going to be a lump where the test was done. I believe it's 3 centimeters in diameter. Don't correct me if I'm wrong. You know, I'm not, you know, like a genius here or anything, but definitely just note that there's gonna be a reaction of some sort at the site. Okay, so next, you need to know what the circulating nurse is for, and as I said throughout the videos, they're basically there for everything. They're going to set up the operating room, they're responsible for safety, positioning, they're going to maintain the sterile field, they do the PACU handoff, they help with the counts, and they're going to basically be in that room, and they're going to be listening for pitch changes for like the OSATs and the cardio monitoring. And they're gonna go talk to anesthesia and see if they need any help. They're trying to ensure the most safety and smooth progression throughout the surgical procedure. Signs of intestinal activity are roughly gonna come within 24 hours, after about the first 24 hours, you're gonna experience flatus or farting, as most people would call it normally. You're typically gonna experience nausea, vomiting in about 30% of patients, and they'll typically administer Zofran or a type of Dramamine. I think it's a scopolamine patch is what it's called. I'm not very good at remembering how to pronounce the longer words outside of reading it myself, but those are going to be your types of treatment for that. The surge tech is basically going to be in there to pass instruments and assist the surgeon that way throughout, and they will also help with the counts. And we'll get into the counts a little later. That's one of my later parts of this. So morphine PCA is another thing she wanted us to go over, and that can be basal or continuous is another word for that, or intermittent. And whenever you're administering morphine, you need to watch for respirations because there can be some depression of that. Okay, so there's going to be a PACU report that the circulator is going to have to handle off. It's going to be a one-on-one handoff. They might include the anesthesia team. It's going to be very detailed. They're going to encourage for questioning. And they're going to possibly, in some institutions, require you to repeat that back to the circulator to make sure that you understand all of the material that you've been given. So then you're going to have a pre-op assessment. I think this was day one that I went over this, but basically you want to go over a lot of stuff. You're going to assess everything. You need to help the patient with their anxiety. You need to get a good history You need to do skin prep. Do they need bathed? Do they need an antiseptic cleaning? Do they need some shaving? Don't use a razor. You want to use electric shaving or some Nair because you don't want to create open wounds for infections to enter. Make sure that you teach not only the patient but also the family, because they may be going through this anxiety and they won't be able to remember a lot of stuff, or maybe they have some medications and they're not really focused on what's going on and what you're saying. But if they have somebody there that can help them understand it and process it then and later, it will help. If there's any detailed questions about the operation itself, you yourself are not qualified to answer those questions. I mean, you can answer what's within your scope of practice, but you're going to really have to get the surgeon, and you're not allowed to take them back, and anesthesia won't take them back unless there is a clear understanding and the patient knows what's going on and doesn't have questions. So there are some pre-op meds. Xanax and Ativan are for your anxiety. You can use Versed or some sedatives for relaxation. Anticholinergics, as we know, are to reduce secretions, both nasal and oral secretions. You want to prevent laryngospasms, which is the vocal cords closing up. You want to reduce coughing and bearing down so that there's not a lot of vagal stimulation going on. There's going to be histamine blockers like Reglan for gastric secretions to decrease those, and possible opioids to help with the anesthetic. And in some cases, you may need to do a GI flush. I know everybody hates that, and you're going to have to take all these laxatives, and nobody wants to spend all that time on the toilet, and they rarely taste good, so you got to watch out for that. You're going to want to make sure that they empty their bladder. The patient, you know, is going to be on the table for a while, and they might be going in there and doing the procedure in the lower abdomen area, and you don't want all that in there. You want to check their vitals about 2 to 3 times once they get in there. Once they lay in the bed, they've emptied their bladder and everything's gone through. You're going to want to check their vitals 2 to 3 times, I'm going to say, because the first one may be altered due to the anxiety, but like after you calm them down, you know, 15 minutes, 30 minutes, you're going to want to retake those. And if they're still abnormal, then you're going to want to report them. You're going to want to do a neuro assessment so you have a baseline for post-op. You're going to want to do a muscular skeletal assessment. Do they have rheumatoid arthritis? Are there any injuries? Can they not be on these positionings? You're going to want to do a nutritional status to make sure that, you know, there's not going to be issues with wound healing due to malnutrition. Do they have enough protein? Are they going to be able to, you know, fight off infections? You want to do a psychosocial assessment. How is the patient going to be able to handle this? A lot of anxiety is going to increase pain. Can they cope with it? Do they have people to support them? How are they going to handle this surgery itself? You know, there may be scar tissue if you do a larger surgery, and that's going to affect body image. You need to help cope with them. You're going to want to be able to get lab assessments as well. Anything that can be fixed will not cancel surgery, but there are things that can't be fixed, like immediately, that may cancel a surgery, such as a bad INR. A bad INR would be anything outside of 2 to 3 for anybody on blood clotting factors. That's their therapeutic range, 2 to 3, I repeat. 1.1 is about the standard INR for me or you or anybody that's not on those types of anticoagulants. Too high of a potassium or any other electrolyte that's too high, you're gonna have to bring that down. That type of imbalance is gonna cancel the surgery. The lower imbalances are probably a little bit easier because they can give them supplements on their way in, and that can raise the level. Glucose levels aren't really going to change anything. Serum creatine levels can cancel a surgery due to kidney failure because that's how they're going to process everything. Pregnancies can cancel because of a fetus, and any woman that goes in for a surgery at the reproductive age, which is puberty to 45, I believe. And if you're within that range, you're going to get a pregnancy done before surgery, because if there is a risk that you are pregnant, then we don't want to harm the fetus. So a chest x-ray is also bad. If you have a bad chest x-ray, they may cancel the surgery. And you have to stress the implementation of the dietary restrictions, the 4 to 8 hours, 12 hours, whatever your facility or physician would require for the surgery. If they don't follow through with that, there's a risk for aspiration, and they can cancel a surgery due to that. there may be alterations in their restriction, and the physician will make that clear based on, you know, maybe they have to take this medication and it needs to be taken with a sip of water or something like that. And it will be made clear, and if they mess with that, you can cancel the surgeries. So informed consent is another point we want to hit on. So the surgeon is responsible for obtaining this. You as a nurse will observe it, and the patient at any time can withdraw this consent. The patient can sign with an X if they're, you know, illiterate or some other issue like that, and they can't sign. Two nurses and one surgeon will be required for phone consent in the event that you need to call somebody to get consent. In the event that it's an emergency and nobody can give consent, two surgeons have to both sign off on why they think that the surgery is important for this scenario. So some risks for VTE are going to be obese patients, people over 40, cancer or cardiac histories, anybody living a sedentary lifestyle. So that could be like a hip fracture, maybe you just don't move, any type of thing that can impair mobility, things like that. Estrogen and contraceptives. I think Jenny said it's very rare that they're in contraceptives anymore, but you know, there is the transgender movement coming on, and people of that demographic may be taking estrogen for their transformation process, I think is what that would be called. I don't want to, you know, be too politically incorrect about it, but for that transformation, they are going to be taking estrogen most likely, and that can affect this. So they may have to stop for the risk of VTE for their surgery. You want to stress that they wear these stockings, even if it is uncomfortable, because these are very helpful for them, and they need to understand that without them, they're increasing risk and causing more problems. Do not do any like leg massages for patients that do have these, because you risk loosening the clot. And make sure that while they're awake, you want to do leg exercises roughly every hour. So for some pre-op steps, there's a 1, 2, 3, 4. For those of you that were in class with me, Joni said there's 4 steps that you need to focus on, and it is on the study guide. What are the 4 steps? So you're going to want to make sure that you ID the patient, you empty their bladder. Once you get them in bed, you go for the vital signs, and afterwards you get them ready with the pre-op meds. So the anesthesia personnel, you have an anesthesiologist and a CRNA. I always thought the anesthesiologist did all the work, but turns out that the anesthesiologist is just there for putting them under and waking them up. The in-between and the whole process is usually monitored by a CRNA, and they're going to be responsible for your INOs, your cardiac pulmonary function, the levels of anesthesia, and your vital signs. So during surgery, there's going to be instrument count. It's important for the full team to focus on this. The circulator and the scrub tech are going to be the ones who really do the count, and they're going to be calling it out as they go. You're going to want to report immediate errors and stop the surgery and try to figure out what happened, where the error has happened immediately. So you're going to count 4 times. You're going to count before you start, during any additions, after the first surgical closure, and at the end of the full procedure. So for site marking, we've all heard horror stories of operations on the wrong site. So the method that you're supposed to follow to prevent this is nurse, surgeon, and patient, all 3 have to mark the same site and be sure that that's what it is. During surgery, before the first incision, there's going to be a timeout period. It's quiet. The circulator is going to read the consent. You're going to confirm the ID, confirm the site, confirm the operation, and this will all be documented. So there's minimally invasive surgeries, or MIS. They're easy recovering, less infections, less scarring, and typically for abdominal ones, you're going to inject a gas to inflate that. And if it's not fully removed at the end, there can cause shoulder pain for a referred pain, and that'll be a sign of this. It's putting pressure on the mesentery nerve, and that's going to be your issue there. So you're going to want to remove that. Excuse me. So the surgical scrub is going to be the technique that the surgeons use, as you know, you wash your hands, and anybody that's watched a medical show knows this, that before the surgery, the surgeon's going to scrub in. So they'll apply their hat and their mask prior to this, and then they're going to waist to shoulders. This is their frame of reference to stay in the sterile zone. So they will wash and they will scrub vigorously for about 3 to 5 minutes based on facilities and products used, and then they will glove themselves and gown up. So malignant hypothermia is a life-threatening condition. It may be genetic. It causes poor thermal regulation, and it begins at the skeletal muscle. Acidosis and dysrhythmia can occur with raised potassium levels caused by this. It's usually caused by sevoflurane. If there is a risk that you may be having this reaction, you will be the first surgical case, so that it is the most sterile for you and avoiding of that. You can get tacky with a low BP. Your skin can molt. It'll have red blotches on it. Cyanosis can occur. Your urine may be brown, iced tea colored from myoglobulin. There's going to be a rise in your end-tidal CO2. There's going to be a high temperature, and that's really a late sign. So if you haven't caught it by now, this is definitely going to be a big indicator. There's going to be jaw and upper chest rigidity for the muscles. The reverse for this is dantrolene, which is a skeletal muscle relaxant. You're going to want to treat this with 100% O2, terminate the surgery if you can, get a Foley in there, and ice everything. You want it IV sites, armpits, neck, everywhere. Just totally cover them in ice. For pain, if the patient reports a 3 on their pain scale, you're going to want to start giving them pain medication, because it's a lot easier to cut it out before it starts going than to play catch up later. Your second day is really going to be your big one for this, and it's going to hit you hard because that's when your anesthesia is wearing off. So you're going to want to make sure that you're really watching them day two. So for positioning, there's a bunch of different positioning, and you're going to want to consider age, weight, any disabilities, IV lines, airway, comfort, and any recommendations or preferences from the physician. One that we went over in class was lithotomy, which is used for rectal and OBGs. A big reason we went over this is because with your legs up so high for so long, you're going to want to lower both legs simultaneously, but slow, so that you can avoid shock from all that circulation starting back up. Next, we're going to go over dehiscence and evisceration. Dehiscence is when there's a coming apart of your surgical wound, and this is going to be a priority for you, a nursing priority. It's going to be over the evisceration, even though the evisceration sounds worse, because this is leading to the actual problem. If the problem's already happening, it's not really a priority over preventing the problem. Prevent before taking care of the actual issue. If you have those, which one is a priority? Okay. So the dehisce is the coming apart, and when it eviscerates, the actual organ is going to start popping through. Okay. So to avoid post-op complications, you're going to want to do your proper assessments. You're going to run your constant BPs every 5 minutes, checking the BPs, the OSATs. You're going to be running the cardiogram stuff constantly. You want to manage their pain, mobilize them, and get the airway going good to avoid hypoxia or hypoxemia. You can adjust their sitting position to a semi-Fowler's, increase the oxygen, things like that. Anything that you know that you can help increase the way they're breathing and helping them get air. Thoracentesis, so that's going to be it's a procedure where it's an aspiration from, you're taking an aspiration of either liquid or air from the pleural sac. There's going to be a stinging feeling. That's when the patient's going to be bending over the table. I reviewed it earlier in here if you need to look. There was a weird section of video where I tried to mimic it. So the patient needs to stay motionless, and there's going to be a follow-up assessment. You need to be constantly aware that if the patient goes tacky, it is an immediate risk, and you need to be acting on that immediately. So there is a risk for an infection or a pneumothorax, collapsed lungs, due to this, because it is a puncture going into that area. It'll be a lot of pain for the patient, and you need to be with them and help them deal with this. So hypoxia, there's going to be some signs like cyanosis, labored or shortened breathing, tachy, unconscious is a big sign that somebody may not be getting enough oxygen or breathing. Any signs that they're not getting enough oxygen or air, really. One that we mentioned in class I have as a side note could be restlessness, but that could also be a symptom of pain. So definitely keep that in your mind, but know that it could just be for pain. When writing up a medication order, there's going to be a couple things you need to look out for. You need to make sure that you have the right medication, the dose, the route, the time, the patient, the signature, usually a reasoning for why. Just make sure that you know how a medication order is filled out, and what things you're going to be looking for when getting that. So now I'm going to go over the electrolytes again. So I'll read over this in full this time. I did type it up in the study guide that I'm reading off my screen now to you guys to make sure that I follow a good line of thought here. But since we are doing this and I have it typed up a little weird, I think it'll be a lot easier to read it this way. So for sodium, it works with water to maintain proper fluid volume. Your kidneys are going to respond to that, and they will either conserve fluid or excrete it based upon this, and it helps control your blood pressure. So your normal levels are going to be 136 to 145. The units will be millimoles per liter, but don't really worry about the units, because your units will typically always be written out the same way. It'll just be the numbers that you want to focus on. So I repeat, that's going to be 136 to 145 for your sodium. For potassium, this is vital to your heart function, cell growth, and muscle contraction. You can replace this orally or via IV. IV is risky, though, so there's some certain dilutions that you're going to want to use when you do an IV version. But you want to make sure that it's 3.5 to 5.0 millimoles per liter. 3.5 to 5 for potassium. For magnesium, it's found in the body's cells, mostly in your bones. It's vital for your metabolism and function of organs and neuromuscular tissues. 1.3 to 2.1 MEQ per liter, MEQ per liter. That's 1.3 to 2.1 for magnesium. Calcium is going to help with nerve impulses and cardiac function, blood clotting, your teeth, your bones, muscle contractions, usually found in dairy products and other things, and it can be given IV if needed, as well as magnesium, same oral or IV. So calcium, you're going to want to maintain 8.5 to 10.2 milligrams per deciliter, mg per deliter, okay? 8.5 to 10.2 for calcium. So phosphate is going to help with muscle, red blood cells, and nervous systems. With calcium, it assists in bone and with bones and teeth. It's absorbed in the small bowels. So this can come from milk, cheese, eggs, meat, fish, etc. You can replace this also orally or IV. 3.0 to 4.5 milligrams per deciliter. 3 to 4.5. And that's for phosphate. Next, I'm going to go back to your CBCs and your reference ranges. White blood counts, 4.5 to 11. It's also times 10 to the third of the microliters. But really just focus on the 4.5 to 11 for your white blood cells. Red blood cells, I memorized it this way, 4 to 5. 4 to 5 for your red blood cells. Add 0.5 if you're a male. So a male is 4.5 to 5.5, and a female is 4 to 5 for red blood cells. Your HGB for a female is 12 to 16. For a male, it will be 14 to 17.4. okay? Your HCT, or hematocrit, is going to be between 42 to 52% for a male, and 6% less at 36 to 46% for a female. HCT, 42 to 52 for a male, 36 to 46 for a female. Your MCVs should be between 80 to 100. Your MCH, 28 to 34. Your MCHC, which is one extra C onto the prior one, you're going to want to keep that 32 to 36. So it's close to the same range, but it's a little bit smaller. Okay, it's right around the upper range of the prior one. RDW, you're going to want to keep 12 to 14.6. RDW, 12 to 14.6. PLT, you want to keep that 150 to 450. PLT, 150 to 450. MPV, you're going to want to keep 6.8 to 10.2. MPV, 6.8, 10.2. Now, the last five normal values I'm going to go over are your pH, 7.35 to 7.45. Your CO2 should be 35 to 45. Your PO2 should be 80 to 100. Your HCO3, 22 to 26. And your OSATs should always be 95 to 100. Anything below 90 in most facilities is going to require intervention. 80 is really bad, so, but they're going to really run 90 as like the minimum. But you want to stay around 95 to 100 for your OSATs. And the final thing for this review is bandemia or left shift. Like I said earlier, it is the immature white blood cells are attacking and they're forming bands of threes when you look at the counts. These can appear two to three different times, but they will be bands of three, and that's why it's called bandemia or left shift, and that is immature white blood cells. All right, guys, good luck.
Okay, so honestly, I don't know where to start. Today was the first day of Pharm 2. Um, 81 slides. So, day one, the first part of this video, so this is probably like the third part. I said there was like 40 slides, and that was rough. Now we're about doubled that. She spent the first hour of a two-hour class going over the syllabus, so in 1 hour, we did 83 slides. It was horribly taught, and honestly, I'm gonna have to do like a book review. So what we're gonna do here is I have the book open next to me. I have a couple page numbers she threw out to us throughout. So I'm gonna run through any of the main stuff that she hit upon. I'm hoping this one's only like 15 minutes. And the third part for this, and the other one will get a study guide in the class, so I'll fill that out and I'll review it and I'll put it on here as the third part of that section. And the third part of this, when we asked her for a syllabus, she said study guide, she said syllabus. So that's just the first line of defense for this. And just to give you guys that aren't in the class a grasp of how class went, she read something, I specifically said, hey, can you repeat that one time? And she said, it's in the book. So it's about where we're at. So it's all in the book. I'm just going to go over what I went through in class as fast as I can, so I remember as much as I can to get into you guys right off the bat. So she started in chapter 26, and we did antibacterials. I'm sorry, I'm not really like looking at you guys. Maybe I'll just put this up here, maybe, and then I can like look at you guys while I'm doing this. So anyway, so antibacterials can only treat bacteria. Just a general thing, when you take an antibiotic, you need to take it exactly how the doctor prescribes it, and don't leave any leftover. Don't, oh, I feel better, I'm not gonna start taking it. Don't just take an antibiotic because you have some leftover. A, you shouldn't have it, and B, you don't take antibiotics if you don't have a bacterial infection. What that's going to do, for those of you that don't know and don't have the background knowledge, when you take an antibiotic, it's going to present itself into the body. And if you don't have that specific infection, the remaining bacteria in your body is going to look at that antibiotic, and it's going to develop a defense to that. So say you have strep in you, you know, Streptococcus aureus, and
it's not causing an infection right now. And they treat it with methicillin. We'll just go with methicillin because this is what it's going to lead to. And they give you, you start taking methicillin and you didn't know that you had that in there, and that's not what it was treating. And now you have that in your body with the strep. There's a chance that that strep can develop a resistance to that, and that's going to turn into MRSA, methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus. So you need to watch out for those things. So definitely just follow the antibiotics how you want. And for those of you who are in the medical profession or going into it, you need to understand that, like, you can't just treat everything with an antibiotic. Obviously, we're past that. It's an old, like, way of thinking. But just in case you didn't know that and you're just starting out, you need to know that stuff. Okay, so basic thing, everybody's body's covered in bacteria. It's a pretty general thing. So bacteria are prokaryotes. So there's bacilli. They're going to be like these rod-shaped things. They're going to be like this shape. Okay, not that you need to know that for this class, but just in general. Cocci, balls, cocks and balls. It's the best I can give you for that. So they're like spherical. Normally they're in clusters. So like the name of the bacteria is just going to tell you like the shape, basically. So like Streptococcus is like a line of circles. Straight circles. And Staphylococci is staph is like for clusters. So it means like clustery. So clustered circles. Okay. So these things can come in gram positive and gram negative. We didn't go into it in this course, so maybe in a microbio thing you'd come to understand that more better. So you'll come to understand that in a micro course, what that actually differentiates to. But realistically, you're going to tell the difference with a stain. It's usually a pink and purple stain, and you'll be able to tell by whether or not it reacts. Anyway, so antibacterials and antibiotics. So literally, there's almost no difference. Literally, I'm looking at the thing, and it says bacterial growth inhibited or kill bacteria, and inhibit bacteria growth or kill bacteria. However, antibiotics are listed as bacteriostatic or bactericidal. Cidal, suicide, so homicide. So when you see here side, think of murder. So kill. And for static, stay. So like you're just halting where it's at. You want to keep it static where it's at. That's only three slides, guys, so good luck here. So antibacterials can basically do anything. They can inhibit the way it's affecting the cell wall, rebuild, act against what it's done. They can inhibit its replication. They can inhibit its synthesis. They can interfere with its metabolism within the cell. There's many different ways that it can come at you. So you have natural resistance in your body, you know, your age, your nutrition, your immunoglobulins, your circulation, white blood cells, organ functions, all those things are going to work together as your base base defense against this. So we add the bacterial, antibacterials and antibiotics whenever your body just doesn't have enough natural base. Side note that she gave us, nosocomial is for hospital acquired. So anytime you hear this is a nosocomial infection, that's hospital acquired. Anything that's that word is going to be hospital acquired. So resistance, as I said earlier, is acquired over other things. There's MRSA, methicillin resistance. VREF is vancomycin resistant. I didn't catch what the EF means. VRSA, VRSA, vancomycin resistant, I'm assuming Staphylococcus aureus. So you need to really just watch out how you use antibiotics, because it can really create these like super infections and things that we don't really want to deal with. The next part is just going over misuse. I already did that with you guys. There's a link explaining resistance. It's a Bill Nye video. If you guys end up wanting the link, I can post the link in here. It's also to YouTube. But otherwise, I'm not going to put it in there. But I can link it if you guys put in the comments, hey, can you link this for me? I can go back in here and get it for you, for those of you not in the class. So antibacterials, antibiotic combination effects, so they can have additive effects, potentiative effects, and antagonistic effects. So I don't really need to look for this one, but additive is going to be things that like work together and produce a greater effect, like it grows. And then your potentiative is like you're giving potential. So like think of that that way. So it's like, hey, this one's going to open the door for this one to get in. So maybe one's going to halt the process of the bacteria to do what it's doing, and then the other one's going to come in and wipe it out. And then antagonistic is like antagonist, so it's against. So they're not really working together, they're working against each other, and you need to watch out for those. All right. Look at that. We went through six more pretty quick there, guys. General adverse reactions you need to watch out with. Hypersensitivity. Well, this is just under allergic reactions. So hypersensitivity, rash, hives, anaphylactic shock. For shock, you're going to do like trouble breathing, wheezing, hives, and a rash and swelling. It's like what everybody thinks of when they're like, oh my God, I'm having an allergic reaction. You know, people's tongues swell up. That's the big one because it's going to prevent airway. So super infections or just opportunistic infections are things you need to watch out for anytime you use an antibiotic. It should always be a part of your assessment or the process you're monitoring. Because when you giving one antibiotic, you need to watch in case there's another infection that could be like piggybacking off of this. And it may not be attacked by this, and you using the antibiotic lowering your normal flora is going to give that the opportunity to capitalize. Things like that are C. diff. So everybody has C. diff. It's a type of bacteria that just resides in your GI. And when you take an antibiotic, you're going to basically destroy a whole bunch of bacteria. And some of that's good bacteria, some of it's bad bacteria. You know, antibiotics don't really precisely just say, oh, hey, this is bad bacteria, and hey, this is what they need in their intestines. So you need to watch out for those things. That's why C. diff comes. And from what I've heard, I haven't actually smelled it myself yet. Or maybe I did and I just don't know it. Anyway, so C. diff is something apparently you can smell and you'll never forget. So organ toxicity is a big thing that you need to look out for. And that's like the ear, the liver, and the kidney. So a lot of these, as we're going to go over them, are going to have ototoxicity, which can be like ear toxicity, or tinnitus, which is going to be like ringing in your ears. The liver, 85% of, you know, these things are going to be catalyzed here. All right, so battery's running low, so I'm going to have to splice this together. Hold on, guys. Okay, had a bit of a technical difficulty. My laptop died. Got a problem with that. Should really keep it charged. Anyway, so as I was saying, 85% of stuff's going to get metabolized in the liver, so that's going to be a big one affected, and the kidney is responsible for a lot of excretion, so you need to watch there. Draw your enzymes, stuff like that, check your levels. Back to the opportunistic infections, I skipped over this. The mouth, skin, respiratory tract, genitourinary tract, and the intestines are going to be your main areas that these opportunistic infections, like I said, the GI for C. diff. So there's going to be narrow spectrum stuff and then broad spectrum stuff. Narrow spectrum is going to be something that targets either gram positive or gram negative, whereas broad spectrum is going to hit both. Typically when you get in there, they find out you do have an infection, they might apply like a weaker, broad spectrum type medication. And that's just to avoid delaying the treatment. And then once they find out that, you know, you have a narrow spectrum, they can narrow down the spectrum, whether it's gram positive or gram negative, they can treat you more effectively that way. Now we're going to go into it a little bit later. But like always culture and I'll find the word later. But always get your culture and you'll find out what's going on. The white blood cell counts are going to definitely tell you whether you have an infection. And later on, we're going to go over, I believe it's lymphocyte versus neutrophils. And when you have those percentages, you'll get a ratio when you get the blood panels. And if the panels are close for those two, it's going to tell you that you have a viral infection. But if there's a strong difference, either one's higher than the other or one's excessively lower, that's going to tell you you have a bacterial infection. So that's when they'll know, hey, we need to go with the broad spectrum really quick and wait until we get an actual culture and find out what's going on. So we went with penicillins next. It's a beta-lactam ring structure. I can't really tell you what she said, but I'm pretty sure she said it's like a box with boxes. She didn't really go into the description when I asked for more. So honestly, this is just a big recap of how hellish this is going to be. But so its action is to inhibit bacterial cell wall synthesis. So for those of you that don't know what that is, so like when it's creating its form of protection, its cell wall. So each cell, most cells have a cell wall, like plant cells, and it goes over the membrane and it helps protect what's on the inside of the cell. So what this is going to do is prevent the bacteria from creating that protection, leaving it totally available to be attacked. So depending on dosage, you'll see a lot of these drugs are definitely dependent on that. It'll start static and then high doses are going to be cidal. There's types of penicillins. There's basic penicillins, broad spectrums, penicillase resistant penicillins, extended spectrum penicillins. And here we go. So I have on 347, for those of you watching, that are in the class and have the book, the main four they have are penicillin procaine, penicillin benzathine, and penicillin sodium. There's also VK. Procaine is for anthrax, is the first listed issue it treats. Benzathine is for syphilis and respiratory infections. Sodium is for septicemia, gas, gangrene, tetanus. VK is for ulcerative gingivitis. Those are just the first list of treatments. There's literally paragraphs. So for those of you that need information in the class, I'd definitely go check it out. But I just hit on the main one that's first. So that's probably what's going to be on the test. And for those of you who are in a different course or at a different school, the first one's probably the one they're going to test you on. Because after that, it gets into more general stuff. And there's also side effects if you need to look those up as well. But there are penicillin side effects generalized in my slides. Broad spectrum, they're the amoxicillins, okay? So you have amoxicillin, clavulante, ampicillin, sulbactam. The amoxicillin is for otitis media, sinusitis, respiratory, skin, and urinary tract infections. Ampicillins for meningitis, endocarditis, septicemia, gastroenteritis, and skin and respiratory and urinary tract infections. Sulbactam, skin, respiratory, intra-abdominal, and gynecologic infections. So those types of things there. The penicillin resistance, dicloxylene sodium, nephcillin, and oxicillin sodium. In that order, bacteremia, which is like a blood infection, endocarditis. So the last two are definitely going to do the same thing. They actually are the same things. And then for extended spectrums, there's only one. So that'll be definitely easier for you guys to remember. It's piperacillin tazobactam. It's for PID and skin and intra-abdominal respiratory infections. All right. That was a lot, but definitely you can slow me down, replay it. I'm glad I'm putting this up for you guys, and we can go over these a little bit. So basic spectrum, they're all penicillins are gonna end in cillin. Their effect, the basics are gonna be effective against gram positive and a few gram negatives. The broad spectrums are gonna be useful against both. The resistant penicillinase resistant ones are gonna be for gram positive. Think they have staph listed as a main thing, endocarditis, heart inflammation, meningitis, brain inflammation. Some more of the more serious inflammations you're gonna have. The extended one are for gram negative. So the penicillinase ones are gram positive, extended is negative. Okay, so then we have beta-lactamase inhibitors. So these are going to inhibit the beta-lactamase, extending their antimicrobial spectrum. Usually these aren't given alone, they're to enhance the penicillins. Some side effects, obviously you're going to have the hypersensitivity, the super infections, tongue discoloration, and tongue inflammation or stomatitis, GI distress, and as always, C. diff. What's important to ask whenever a patient tells you that they have an allergic reaction, because almost every single one of these drugs, if not all of them, is going to say that hypersensitivity or an allergic reaction is going to be a big deal. So when you ask a patient, hey, do you have any allergies? And then they say, hey, I have this allergy. And you're like, okay, well, if you've never worked with this patient before, you're going to want to ask, hey, what happens when you take the drug? And they might say, oh, I get nauseous, or my stomach doesn't feel well. And like some of those things, like, yeah, they don't, it's not like a good reaction for them, and like they don't feel good with that. But like sometimes those are side effects of the medication, and they're not an allergic reaction. It's just something uncomfortable for the patient. So they might actually be able to take it. And like patient education is going to really help you out, making sure they know what's going on. All right, so for the nursing process, mostly this is going to get really good for like all of them. So I'm not really going to go over the other ones. I'll go over this really slow for you guys. But it's pretty much the same for almost all of them. Okay, so for your assessment, you want to assess for their allergies. Now, for penicillin specifically, cephalosporins and penicillins both have that ring structure, and that ring structure is going to be what makes them similar. And because they're so similar, if you have an allergic reaction to this one, you're probably going to be allergic to this one. So definitely be aware of that. If they say, oh, I have a penicillin reaction, then you can't give any of the cillins and you can't give the cephalosporins. So be aware of that because they might not know that that is a connected thing, but you need to make that connection, or the physician, somebody needs to make that connection, so that you don't give them something that they truly are allergic to. So you need to evaluate lab results and hepatic enzymes. Like I said, 85% is processed in the liver, so you need to really watch your enzymes and levels. Your nursing diagnosis are infection or at risk for infection, and there might be some nutritional imbalances related to like nausea and vomiting. So you're planning, you're always planning for the patient's infection to be controlled and eliminated. But for a day-to-day thing, when you're in the clinic, you're gonna want to aim for like no abnormal temperatures, their pulse stays normal, they're gonna have this level of intake or output for the day. So definitely keep the track of those things. You want to report trouble swallowing, and you want to encourage anybody that has an infection to like promote really well hygiene, make sure they wash their hands. And they're going to want to avoid anybody that's immunosuppressed. So by immunosuppressed, for those of you that don't know, that's anybody with like a weaker immune system. Now, the elderly and children are going to have those weaker immune systems. The elderly due to, deterioration, and the children due to lack of exposure. You're also going to have people on the transplant list who are going to have that issue, and people who are on immunosuppressants, or even people who have autoimmune diseases. All right, so your interventions are always going to take a lab culture. Like I said, you want to find out what you're treating so you can make sure you treat it best. Monitor for the super infections or the opportunistic things. Always keep track of, like, maybe something extra is going on. I need to know what's going on. And I think she said, let's just go with 15 minutes to an hour after you administer an antibiotic for the first time. You're going to want to make sure, hey, like, they didn't say they were allergic, but maybe they really are. So we're going to want to check on that. How are you feeling? It may take a couple days, so don't let them rush and be like, hey, I'm not feeling well. Like, we need to stop this. Like, it takes a few days. It might not work immediately. So definitely work with them and try to educate them on as much as you can, because an educated patient is a helpful patient, and a helpful patient creates a better medical experience and definitely helps you do your job. Okay, so now we're gonna get to practice questions. I'll give you like 3 seconds right now to pause it and go read the questions yourself below. And then I will go over the answers. Okay, so the answer to number one is going to be B, monitor a patient for signs and symptoms of a superinfection. No, it's A. Wait until culture results are received before initiating antibiotic. My bad, guys. I skipped one. I didn't mark that one, and I had to reread the question. But yeah, you're definitely going to want to wait until you find out what's going on. Okay, question two is B, C, and E. You're not going to want to do A because you don't give it with extended penicillins. You want to do B because you should always do that. C, you should always do. D, you want to increase fluid because you want to make sure that this goes through their body and gets processed, and you don't want to make that halt. And E, also a thing that you should always do. For question three, C, what are we treating? Always make sure you culture that wound. So now we're on cephalosporins. So this is the thing, has beta-lactam structure. It's similar to penicillin. These, like penicillin, has a cillin ending. These are going to have a ceph beginning. That can be CEPH or CEF. Now these are going to be for respiratory, urinary, skin, bone, joint, and genital infections. For those of you that are in the course, this is going to be coming up in the study guide, but this is going to be the thing that focuses on the first, second, third, fourth, and fifth gens. And basically for the general generations, what it's going to be is generation one did it this way, two, three, four, five, you know, like your grandparents did it this way, your parents did it this way, you're doing it this way. They're all the same structure and effectiveness. It's just the route by which they take care of the issue. And I don't mean route as in like injection or orally, not like that, but like how they attack. So like some will, this is just a generalization, like this isn't actual facts. I can get you that from the book, but say one attacks like the cell wall, one attacks the protein synthesis, one attacks the RNA synthesis, you know, stuff like that. They take different routes for halting things. So first gen, 353. I'm gonna try to give everybody the main ones. So you have cefadroxil is for pharyngitis, tonsillitis, UTIs, and skin infections. Cefazolin sodium is for endocarditis, septicemia, skin, bone, joint, biliary, respiratory, and UTIs. Cefalexin is for otitis media and skin, bone, joint, respiratory, urinary tract infections. But yeah, so those are your three main ones: cefadroxil, cefazolin, and cefalexin. So first generations are going to be mostly gram positive, a little bit of gram negative. Keep that in mind. Second generation is going to be gram positive and gram negative, so a little bit of both. So instead of generation one only could do a little bit of both, you know, mainly positive, a little bit of negative. Second generation is going to cover both, so it's a bigger broad spectrum. So you're going to have cefactor, cefadroxil. No. Why did I put cefroxil? Anyway, cefactor, cefroxine, seam, and we're going to go with that had to be cefoxitin. Like I said, she went really fast and she wouldn't repeat things, so it's going to be really difficult for me to read my own writing sometimes. But I think she said cefoxitin and cefuroxamine are going to be your two main ones that you're going to look out for second generation. Cefoxitin is for septicemia intra-abdominal, gynecological and all those, bone, skin, UTIs. Cefuroxime is for meningitis Lyme disease, gonorrhea, and then the usual. So cefuroxime, your oxime is going to go for meningitis and Lyme disease. Oxitin is septicemia and intra-abdominal. Definitely go for those. So now we're getting on to the thing that I said. Generation 3, 4, and 5 are all going to be against both gram-positive and gram-negative. They've really developed. Ceftonir and cefotaxime are the main third generation ones that she told us to focus on. So taxime is for bacteremia, septicemia, meningitis, typhoid fever. That's an intense disease. You guys should look that up. It's really, really intense. I think it's typhoid Mary. Typhoid Mary. There's a big story on that. It happened in New York. Big study done on that. So I would go research that if I was you guys. It's interesting. Gynecological, skin, bone, joint, intra-abdominal, stuff like that. And then the other one is Ceftonir. That's for otitis media, acute sinusitis, tonsillitis. So, dinner. So, think of dinner. So, your sinuses, you know, you eat, taste things with your smell, and your tonsils, so your nose and throat, dinner. Probably a weird thing to remember, but that's what I came up with right there, just dinner. So nose and throat for that one. Okay, so we're going to go to 4. Cefepime is what she said. And it is not listed here. Oh, yes, it is. Cefepime is listed right here. Cefepime is for bacteremia, respiratory skin, intra-abdominal. So basically just for bacteremia and then the basics. For fifth generation, you want to look out for ceftaroline fosamil. This is for skin and respiratory infections. That's the main one there. And the fourth and fifth are highly resistant to destruction by beta-lactamases. So that's an interesting thing. At generation three, you will have an increased resistance to destruction by beta-lactamase, but 4 and 5, you'll have a highly resistant to beta-lactamases. Wow, I'm only a quarter of the way done. This is insane. Side effects are the same. An extra side effect is altered taste or dysgeusia. D-Y-S-G-E-U-S-I-A. It's just altered taste. GI distress, bleeding, seizures, nephrotoxicity, Steven Johnson's, elevated hepatic enzymes. So watch for the kidneys and liver. Don't do this with alcohol. Can cause flushing, dizziness, headaches, stuff like that. Uricosurics, don't take those with it. It decreases their effectiveness. Assessment is basically the same. You want to make sure that your urine output is about 30 cc's every hour. You can do the 8-hour thing and just make sure you have 240. Just an average, really. There's the bacterial versus viral. If they're close, it's viral. Far apart, they're bacterial. Your monocyte readings aren't going to come up until like 24 hours after. So if somebody comes in, hey, I have a cough. I think I have an infection. Can you check it out? When did it start? Only a couple hours ago. You're not really going to have a monocyte reaction. I mean, we can take the panel, but nothing's really going to happen. And you need to educate the patient that just because you have a cough post-treatment doesn't mean that you're still sick. Coughs can linger for, I believe, 3 to 6 weeks post-curing. And that's probably just your body recovering from, you know, what it's done. You know, maybe you have some throat irritation from a throat infection, and you're like, really, really coarse, and you're still recovering from that physically, not exactly on the immuno level. Nursing interventions are about the same. You should advise them to take this medication with food if there's some gastric irritation. So now we're on practice questions again. 3 seconds, go ahead, pause the video. So the first one's D. Definitely, it's going to be a sign of an opportunistic infection. That's something you want to go to right away. You want to make sure that they're aware, hey, you need to capitalize on this when it comes. Question 5, yeast infections are common when the normal body flora is disrupted. So that's D. So you need to watch out for that in women. You're going to get the possibility of getting a yeast infection on antibiotics. I believe they recommend dairy things like Activia and stuff like that, like yogurts and buttermilk and dairy products to help protect from the yeast infections. So now we have macrolides, erythromycins. So these are going to be all the things that end in myosin, M-Y-C-I-N. So they're going to apply these types of things. This is going to be applied like baby's eyes to prevent STDs or STIs, as they're more commonly called now, after delivery. So like say the mother has an STI and they deliver the baby, they're going to want to like make sure they get this on the eyes so that the baby isn't blinded by this infection. Jesus. Cats are fighting. So 50S ribosomal subunits are what they attack. They're broad spectrum. They're effective against most gram-positive and some gram-negative. So they are broad spectrum, but they're very weak broad spectrum, mainly for gram-positive. Like I said, increased doses if you want to get to the cidal stages. They're for moderate respiratory sinus, skin, soft tissue, GI tract. Diphtheria, impetigo, and STIs. 355 is for these. I'm just going to give you a couple lists of them real quick. Nothing super serious. Clarithromycin, erythromycin, and vidaxomicin. Vidaxomicin? Yeah. So those are your macrolides. Basically, like erythromycins for like acne, impetigo, tonsillitis, urethritis, STIs, Legionnaires, PID, diphtheria, respiratory and skin infections. Clarithro is for otitis media, tonsillitis, duodenal ulcer. But fidaxomicin, this is interesting, it's only used to treat CDAD. So definitely watch out for that. If you see Fidax, CDAD. Fidax, CDAD. That's going to help me remember it. So maybe it'll help you guys. For side effects, basically all the same. Dysgeusia, tooth discoloration, GI, watch for C. diff. nephrohepato, Stevens-Johns, tinnitus is ear ringing, rototoxicity, headache, seizures. Drug interactions, they're going to really increase blood thinners. So warfarin, theophylline, and carbamazepine are going to be increased effects. Fluconazole, ketoconazole, itraconazole, verapamil, and diltiazem and clarithromycin are all going to increase erythromycin levels. Anything with an azole, for all of the things A-Z-O-L-E, those are going to be antifungals. And then these things are going to create a risk for sudden cardiac death. So, you know, like, and she literally put that in small print, like, you know, you could die from cardiac death. And the levels can be reduced by antacids. So I think we'll go over it later. She does. I'm going to go over it now just so everybody knows. Antacids, usually you probably shouldn't take, but for those of you that do need to take it, you need to follow a 2-2 rule. So you need to take it 2 hours prior to the medication or 2 hours after the medication, so that they don't really interact. Assessments are the same. Diagnosis is the same. Planning is the same. Interventions are the same. CNS, I finally found my note on it. It's culture insensitivity. Took me a while before I looked that up. Next, we're going to go into oxazolidinones. I know, guys, we're halfway through. Bear with me here. I wrote Linda and Tolly. These are going to be the main ones for these. Yeah, so all that's listed is linazolid and tidezolid, linotide. So definitely remember linotide. These are also 50S ribosomals, bacteremia, sepsis, MRSA, VRE, respiratory skin infections. The line's going to go for more of the broad stuff, but tidezolid, it literally only lists skin infections. So Tide for your skin. So like it's for clothes. Like think Tide for your laundry detergent. Those are your clothes that goes on your skin. So Tide's for the skin. It's gonna help me remember it. Hopefully it helps you. Moving on to what's next. We're finally halfway. Side effects. Discoloration, GI, peripheral. This one has peripheral neuropathy. So the zolids may cause peripheral neuropathy. It's nerve damage in the peripheral tissues. Headaches, anemia, thrombocytopenia, neutropenia, C. diff. Now we're on to... Now, next is going to be lincosamides. They're not on the exam, so I'm going to skip over that because a large portion of the people that are going to be watching this are probably in class, so we're just going to go over the main things. But for those of you at home, definitely go over lincosamides. They treat acne, bacteremia, septicemia, MRSA, the usual. Side effects, big thing is cirrhosis, XEROSIS, and pancytopenia. She told us to look that up, and I will look it up for later on. Say reduction in all blood cells, both white and red. So now you know. So now we're on to glycopeptides. These are going to be most common. Vancomycin. Also listed is oritavancin and telavancin. So Vance. Glycopeptides are Vance. Basically from MRSA. Basically is the big thing for these. They can treat C. diff, but they can also cause C. diff because, like I said, all antibiotics can cause C. diff, but this one's also used to treat it. These are effective against gram-positive, and they affect cell walls. Normal side effects, but they have red neck or red man syndrome. This happens when you inject IV too rapidly. I think it's supposed to be 35 to 45 minutes. And don't quote me on that, but I believe that's what she stated. And it can cause severe hypotension, red blotching. And pretty much the usual toxicities. Don't take it with alcohol. Ketolides are the next thing. Clarithromycin. It's the only one listed. It's for MRSA and community-acquired pneumonia. Telly. It's like the telephone game. So you play the telephone game. If anybody's played it, you know, you whisper a secret. They tell the next person. They tell the next person. They tell the next person. And then you see if it's any different by the end. But basically, what we can use from telly for the telephone game is its community. So you communicate through other people. So it's going to treat the community-acquired MRSA and pneumonia. So anything with the communities, telly, telephone, communicate, community. Hopefully that can help some of you out here. It's also effective against H influenza and S pneumonia. This affects protein synthesis, the ketolides, that is. All right, side effects. The big difference ones are visual disturbances, and it can exacerbate myasthenia gravis, however you want to pronounce it. Now we're going to be on to the questions. Question 8, 3 seconds to get there. Vancomycin is going to be the answer for that one. Question 9D, instruct the patient to report any loose stools or diarrhea. That's for P. colitis. Question 10, it's going to be A, B, C, D, E, and F. That's what we discussed as a class. It does say that C is not a correct answer, and that's probably because it does treat C. diff, but like I said, all of them can cause C. diff. So when you take an NCLEX, for those of you that are using this to study for that type of material, and I'm assuming you're not using my beginning videos for that, but if it states that it can treat C. diff, then you probably shouldn't list C. diff as a side effect. You should be aware that it is, but on test day, do not put that down. Tetracyclines, they inhibit protein synthesis, they're broad spectrum, and therefore both. They are a strong broad spectrum one, both positive and negative. Effective against H. pylori and MRSA, acne, anthrax, plaque, gingivitis, chlorea, STIs. Don't give it to children under 8 because it can permanently stain their teeth. Then it has the typical things as the side effects. You know, I realize that her question numbers are horrible because we just did 8 and 9 and now the next question is 7. Anyway, so drug and food interactions, milk products, antacids, oral contraceptives, penicillins, aminoglycosides. So the aminoglycosides are going to be for nephrotoxicity risks. Penicillins can cause bacterial resistance. Oral contraceptives are almost always decreased, and you should always take a secondary thing when you're on antibiotics, or, you know, not have sex, just practice abstinence, if you're that type of person. Antacids, like I said, 2 and 2, and milk products, amino and doxy, let me see if I can find the full name of these. Oh, I think it's demi. Yes. So, demi, clioxylene, and doxycycline. Milk can actually help increase their effects. But typically you're going to want to avoid milk products, because most infections that are going to be in the respiratory tract are going to produce a lot of phlegm, and those things are going to increase phlegm. So you're going to want to avoid that. Assessment, diagnosis, planning, typically the same. Interventions are the same. Usually don't give doxy to the patients that are pregnant, because like I said, tetracyclines can permanently stain teeth, and you want to avoid that. Okay. Practice question again. 3 seconds. The answer is C. Like we said, don't take them with an antacid. It's a no-no. Next one is glycyclic cycline. Glycylcycline, that's what we're going to call it. Affects protein synthesis, and they're static. Staph A, E. coli, Streptococcus pyogenes, K. pneumonia, C. perfringens, complicated skin and intra-abdominal infections. This is not a common treatment. Side effects, hyperglycemia and hypokalemia. So, glycemia, kalemia, I don't really have one for that, but glyce up your hyperglycemia and hypokalemia. Don't really have a way for you to remember that one right off the bat, but that's one of its effects. So, aminoglycosides, their action is protein synthesis, and they are cytal. Gentamicin and streptomycin are your most common. Brenna said gento is something they use in the PICU and NICU for infants. They affect gram negatives. And you want to typically save them for serious respiratory infections. You can use them for UTIs and stuff, but you should save them for the respiratory infections. They can cause seizures, photosensitivity, and anemia, as well as the other standard ones. Don't give them at the same time as a penicillin. She did say that you'll see Ampgen in the hospital very often. They'll give ampicillin and gentamicin at the same time. But you're not injecting them simultaneously. Ampicillin's going to go in first. It's over a couple minutes. And then the gentamicin is going to go over like 30 minutes to an hour, and it's going to inject slower. So while they do go at the same time, you don't inject simultaneously. They can't mix. Increase oral anticoagulants, and that's the last main thing. Check vital signs, renal and liver. The usual checkups for all of these. Get a sample, check everything. All right, question 6. 3 seconds. Okay, B is your answer. It's 9 o'clock. So a peak level is going to be taken directly after they take the medication, and a trough level is going to be taken just before they take the medication. The trough is going to be the lowest level of the medication in the system, and the peak is going to be the highest. So you can really derive that on your own. Stop. You're eating a box, bro. Don't do that. Table 30-4. Jeez, that's a couple pages up here. Holy crap. She's definitely way off now. Yeah, I don't know what she's talking about, because 30-4 isn't even in that chapter. Floxacin is how they're going to end. I can't even find it because there's no page. I'm so sorry, guys. Levofloxacin is going to be the most common. It's for bad respiratory infections. Cipafloxacin is for anything below the belt. That sip didn't make sense, but cipo. Cipolo. Cipolo. so you sit below the belt. So those are for the UTIs. The amoxifloxacin is for pneumonia. And they interfere with the DNA gyrase. So DNA synthesis is what they attack, and they're bactericidal. Side effects, big ones that are different are eye damage, tendonitis, and tendon rupture. So fluoro is going to mess with your tendons. So remember that one. That's going to be the main one. They're probably going to ask a question, hey, which one of these is going to affect tendons? And you're going to have to know that it's anything with a fluoxacin in it. Assessments are the same. Interventions are basically the same. You're going to want to advise them to use sunblock for going in the sun. A lot of these have photosensitivity, so you know, sunblock's basically just a good thing to do. Sputum collection for respiratory infections, just a side note. So sputum's like what's in there, so like they gotta hack it up, not spit, so you want them to really get something going. We're doing another question. 3 seconds. Okay. As I just told you literally 5 seconds ago, if you paused, fluoros are going right for your tendons, so you should have got that one. C. Now we're on lipopeptides. Daptomycin is the most common. These are going to inhibit protein, DNA, and RNA synthesis for complicated skin infections. So major side effects here that are different are going to be chest pain, neuropathy, hypotension, hyperkalemia, hyperglycemia. So this one can do hypos of like three different things: tension, kalemia, glycemia, hyper. And it also causes rhabdomyolysis, which is muscle breakdown. The next things are unclassified drugs: chloramphenicol, quinoxin, daflupirazine, bolotaximab. I'm not gonna go over these because she literally skipped them and was like, nah, you should know them, but we're moving on. Okay. Sulfamides are gonna be things with sulfa in it. I don't know why she mentioned this, but they were discovered in 1935 to be selective against bad things and not good bacteria. Sulfapromaxazole is the most common, she said. They inhibit folic acid synthesis. They're static. They're for gram-negative. Otis media, meningitis, malaria. That's a different one. Malaria. Look out for that with the sulfs. Side effect that's different is crystalluria and urine failure and blood dyscrasias. So crystalluria, sulfa. Assessment, diagnosis, and planning similar. Warn them to wear the sunblock. You're going to want to take these with a full glass of water. So with the sulfs, you're going to increase fluid intake. You're going to observe for any blood reactions for the blood dyscrasia. Yet again, don't take your antacids. All right, so we have questions. 3 seconds. Okay, so question A, I just told you, increased fluid intake. So A, the common name for trimethoprimisulfamexazole is Bactrim. So A. Question 13 is D, UTI, most commonly prescribed for. Question 14 is B, eucolitis, most common use. It can also treat Crohn's and rheumatoid arthritis. I have a page number, guys. I have a page number, 371. All right. So nitromidazoles, metronidazole, metronidazole. Treats acne, amebiasis, bacterial vaginosis, endocarditis, meningitis, giardiasis, septicemia, trichomoniasis, CDAD, and then the typical infections that we would talk about. This disrupts DNA and protein synthesis in bacteria and protozoa. Good against STIs, most commonly used for C. diff. Side effects, insomnia and weakness. It's one of those ones that's going to cause a big reaction. Tooth and tongue discoloration, peripheral neuropathy, and seizures. That's about all I got for this one. And I know it's been 46 minutes just for this first day of this section. So there's a lot going on, and I hope that we can really sum this up and I can get to the third part and really get you guys a good study guide for those of you that watch this and really need some help in the class. Catch you guys in part two. Okay, so day four now. Class was a little bit better than the first day of Pharm on day two. So today we got anti-tuberculars, antifungals, antivirals, I think that's it. No, and then we're gonna have peptides, anti-malarials, and anti-helminthics. Okay, so we'll just jump right in. Like usual, I'm just gonna read off the slides, hit any major points that she came across. So first you have tuberculosis, the etiology, everybody knows it's literally just tuberculosis, but there's Mycobacterium tuberculosis is acid fast bacillus. Like we talked about, bacillus are going to be the tube-like structures. Not that you need to know that, but just some good knowledge for those of you interested. So it's transmitted person to person via droplets. So that's going to be like coughing, talking, sneezing, things like that nature. Patients at risk are going to be the immunocompromised, as we discussed prior in the video. The elderly, the kids, immunosuppressed, things of that nature, kidney failure, living or working in a high risk residential area like prison, elder homes, things like that, injecting illicit drugs, healthcare workers that are in contact with these patients are going to have a risk for that. So, some symptoms. There's a cough, fever, night sweats, GI distress, weight loss, positive acid fast bacilli in the sputum or bloody sputum, like we've talked about. You know, sputum's what you're hacking up, not just your spit. They're going to recommend prophylaxis if you've come into contact with it. You're immunosuppressed, a Latin infection, injection drug users might need to use it, or a recent immigrant from a high prevalence country. So, moving on to the drug combinations, there's single drug therapy, which you're typically not going to use because that can take up to 2 years to fully treat it. Then there's multi-drug therapy. I think it's two or more, usually like 3 to 5, I think is what she said. And that'll take 6 to 9 months to do that. So for selections, there's the first line drugs, isoniazid, rifampin, rifabutin, rifapentine, pyrazinamide, ethambutol. They're more effective and they're less toxic than the second line. So combination therapy, it is a minimum of 3 to 5 drugs. So the initial phase is gonna be like 1 to 2 drugs, just to start you out for the first 2 months. And then after that, they're going to start adding in the continuation phase for the next 4 to 7 months. The treatment regimen, like I said, is divided into phase 1 and phase 2. Phase 1 being your initial phase with 2 drugs, and phase 2 being the final 4 to 7 months with the remaining drugs. What? Oh. Sorry, we had a temporary break there. Back to, where was I at? Side effects? Yeah, side effects. So, the ones that she highlighted on, you know, they're going to be the normal ones: headaches, dizziness, confusion, GI stress, neuropathy. But she focused on ocular toxicity, so your eyes, ototoxicity, the ears, nephrotoxicity, respiratory depression, thrombocytopenia, And if you take rifampin, which is one of the medications that we mentioned earlier, it's going to turn your body fluids orange, your tears, your sweat, and you're not going to want to wear like white because it's going to stain. If you have soft contact lenses, it's going to stain those permanently. So you need to make sure that your patient's aware of what's coming when they're taking that medication. Pyridoxin, vitamin B6, hyperglycemia, hyperkalemia, hypophosphatemia, and hypocalcemia are some risks there. You're going to want to make sure that you just check the labs and check all your panels when you're doing these types of things to be sure. Isoniazid, or INH is the abbreviation next to it. That doesn't mean inhalation, we went over, because it's a oral or intramuscular thing. It inhibits the bacterial wall, cell wall synthesis. So like I was talking about, the cell wall is like a protective layer that protects like the inner membranes. So by breaking that down, it makes it more susceptible to breakdown by your immune system. So some side effects and adverse reactions, typical dry mouth, GI, constipation, but there is blurred vision, photosensitivity, and ringing in the ears, tinnitus, drowsiness, dizziness, neuropathy, psychotic behavior, tremors, and seizures. There's hyperglycemia, hepatotoxicity, thrombocytopenia, agranulocytosis is another one. So definitely just be watching your CBCs. Tuberculosis in special populations. So there's three of them that we went over in class: pregnancy, HIV, and pediatrics. So for pregnancy and HIV, it's basically normal treatment. For the pregnancy, you're gonna want to weigh risks versus benefits. The risk being, you know, the fetus undergoing early birth or some defects there, but the reward is, you know, you're getting rid of this infection that's very serious. So you're gonna just continue normally. And it wins on that one. HIV, you're just immunosuppressed, so you definitely should be on the full regimen. For pediatrics, they're gonna take Isoniazid, and they're gonna show signs the fastest. So peds will show the fastest signs.
All right.
So moving on to the assessment, you're going to want to assess for hearings and if it includes streptomycin. So that's one of the only different assessments like we've gone over. You know, your nursing assessments and diagnosis and your planning are all relatively dissimilar between all of them. And I'm going to go over just the key things in those ones because we all know the basics, or we've at least gone over them by now. So for the assessment, just assess for hearing changes if they have streptomycin in their drug regimen. For planning, you want to plan by the second to third month that they will test negative for the acid bacilli, but they have to still continue their medication. You want to stress that, just like an antibacterial, that you want to finish the regimen that you're on because you don't want to risk that infection getting worse. Also, we all know the TB test is a skin test. If you've come into contact with TB and you've had TB, you're always going to test positive whether or not you currently have TB, because it just tests for you coming into, if you've come into contact with it. So if you have come into contact with it, you're going to want to always do a chest x-ray to confirm or deconfirm that diagnosis. So your interventions is you're going to want to administer the INH, which we went over was the Isoniazid, an hour before or 2 hours after meals. The vitamin B6 or pyridoxine, take that as prescribed to prevent the peripheral neuropathy. Always monitor their hepatic functions, and like I said, emphasize that they comply with the thing. So we have fungal infections, so basically like yeast, we went over that. These things are going to like it when it's dark and moist places, like in your mouth, you get thrush. Fungal infections, I think the one that we listed was candidiasis. So local infections, you'll get mucous membranes, hair, nails, moist skin areas. There, it can also be vaginal. So then you can have systemic infections, which are going to be the more severe versions of these infections, and they're going to infect your lungs, your abdomen, and your central nervous system. All right, so classifications, they're opportunistic infections. So these are going to be like your yeast infections, things that come on when you're immunocompromised or a debilitated population. You're on antibiotics, chemo, corticosteroids, things like that. They're going to come in when you're immunosuppressed or susceptible to these types of things. Primary infections like blastomycosis, histoplasmosis, things like that. But definitely just worry about people who are immunosuppressed, because that's where it's going to come on the quickest. So some antifungal drugs that we have, there are antimycotics. So you have pollens, azoles, antimetabolic, echinocandins. The echinocandins are the newest class, and we'll go over all of these individually. But so for pollens, we have amphotericin B. It's IV only. You can only give this through IV. It's for severe and systemic infections. So it's going to bind to the cell membranes and cause some cell permeability and leakage of the cellular contents. So basically what this is going to do is increase the permeability of the wall so that everything in the cell can like kind of leak out, and then it's basically breaking itself down by that because it can't hold itself together anymore. So you'll get flushing, fever, chills, headache, tachypnea, the usual dizziness, there's some parathisia, thrombophlebitis. High doses can cause nephrotoxicity, hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia. Reactions usually begin 1 to 3 hours after initiating the drug. To avoid reactions, you're going to pre-treat about 30 to 60 minutes with, like, you know, Tylenol, diphenhydramine, hydrocortisone. Basically just pre-treating, and that's so that you can get rid of like the minor inconveniences of a reaction. It's not going to get rid of the major ones, so you'll still be able to focus on that. Nystatin is the next polyene we're going to go over. It can be given oral or topical. Binds to sterols, causing loss of intracellular potassium and other cell contents. So like that's going to, you know, affect like membrane passageways and stuff. So you need to watch for, understand that mechanism for that. The dosage is about 5 to 7 milliliters orally. You're going to swish and swallow. Normal skin irritation, rash, GI distress, hyperglycemia, tachy, angioedema, and bronchospasms are the most severe, as well as Stevens-Johnson's, which is a skin disorder. So now you have the azoles. These are all going to end in azole, so you'll be able to tell these with a suffix on the drug itself. So azole is going to be an antifungal. These can be given oral, IV, vaginal, or topical. They increase the permeability of the cell wall and by inhibiting ergosterol synthesis. I believe she said ketoconazole is the main one that you're going to see. Side effects are pretty standard. There is hypocalcemia, dysrhythmias, hepatotoxicity, and nephrotoxicity are the main ones you want to watch for, aside from, you know, headache, rash, and GI distress. Some anti-metabolites we're going to have. Their actions are going to be selectively penetrating the cell and disrupt RNA and DNA synthesis. They're well absorbed in your GI. Flucytosine, I think, is the main one we mentioned in class. You're going to use this in combination with other antifungals, such as the amphotericin B. And you're going to want to watch renal and hepatic impairment. So, you know, make sure they're drinking a lot of fluids and watch their panels. Echinocandins, there's only about three because this is the newest one, and they're all going to end in fungin. So make sure you're looking out for that suffix. And if you know, like, fungus is, well, for antifungals, fungin you should be able to get that pretty quickly. These drugs aren't absorbed in the GI, so they have to always go IV. They're going to inhibit biosynthesis of essential components of the cell wall and mess with reproduction. So some side effects are just injection site, hepatic stuff, and histamine-mediated reactions. For the assessment, you want to watch their hepatic and renal functions to make sure they're getting an appropriate dose. Anything else special here? So for your interventions, you're just going to want to watch, take them as prescribed, don't do alcohol while you're doing this, report as many side effects as you can. They're new drugs, we need to understand what's going on and if anything's too severe. Evaluation, no fungus afterwards is really what we're looking for. So we have antivirals, and they can't be treated with antibiotics like I went over earlier in the Pharm section of this review. Antibiotics are for bacterial infections, and some people, you know, occasionally will use them to treat viral infections, and that's going to cause a bunch more problems and how we end up with these super diseases. So more focus on an antiviral drug when you have a viral infection. So be sure what you have. Typical droplet precautions, you know, coughing, sneezing, talking. So common infections, the top three are going to be the flu, influenza, herpes, and hepatitis. The common cold is a type of virus as well, but you're just going to do typical support care for that. You know, your Tylenol, Advils, you know, lozenges, stuff of that nature. So the flu is highly contagious, as we all know. It's nose, throat, and lungs. There's three antigen types. Basically, what you're going to go with is A is moderate to severe infection, B is a mild infection, and C is respiratory. So note, C is respiratory, B is mild, and A is the moderate to severe. Now, when they do the flu vaccines, there's typically a tri or a tetra or also quad, if you want to call it a quad, but they're usually vaccinating for 3 to 4 strains. So what they do is basically, I'm pretty sure the predictions start in Australia, and then they go by their flu season and then estimate what our flu season will be based off of what they had to do things like that. That's just kind of like a side note about it. I'm not 100% on that, but I do believe I went over that in virology in my undergrad. So basically the flu is a shotgun vaccine. You're trying to get what they think's coming, and that's why people still get sick. It is important to get that vaccine because, you know, you're preventing the spread of a disease and the mutation if you are against what they think is coming. So it's still a work in progress on knowing what it is because there's so many different strains, but you want to make sure that you get that vaccine so that you can help protect the immunosuppressed from that. Signs and symptoms, basically anything that makes you look horrifyingly sick. It's pretty much what you got to go with there. So herpes virus, there's 5 different types. One is cold sores, you know, it's caused by stress. 2 is genital herpes. If you have an outbreak, you're not allowed to do a vaginal delivery because you may give it to the child. Typically, they will put you on some type of medication if they know that you have this to prevent a breakout so that this is okay. Then you have the chickenpox for number 3, shingles, same. Mononucleosis is number 4, so mono. And number 5 is for a weakened immune system, so cytomegalovirus, CMV. So I think she said there next we're doing hepatitis. So she said something about like A through G, but basically we just need to know A, B, C. A is your fecal oral type stuff, B is your things that we actively vaccinate against, and C is going to be the most serious one that you can get. When you read the labs for these, AB means you have the antibodies, AB antibody. AG means always growing, so that means that they have a current infection and you need to watch out that they are currently present with this issue. Transmissions are standard, needle sticks, intimate sexual contact, or childbirth. It's a serious liver function, serious liver infection, and they can be bloodborne. So healthcare professionals need to be aware, like if you're treating somebody with a hepatitis infection, that you could get that. So be very wary of dealing with that. Signs and symptoms: fatigue, malaise, nausea, abdominal pain, jaundice is a big one. Keep your panels going, and watching those is a good way to detect it. Next, we have non-HIV antivirals to prevent or delay the spread of the viral infection. It's just going to inhibit the replication. The big one for influenza is going to be Tamiflu. It decreases the spread, shorten the signs and symptoms, and you'll just have some pretty crappy general side effects. Nothing too intense, you know, just GI distress, abdominal pain a little bit, headaches, stuff of that nature. Nothing serious. So herpes simplex antivirals are going to interfere with DNA synthesis. Cytomegalovirus antivirals use CMV retinitis in people with AIDS. So it's going to inhibit the DNA polymerase. Side effects besides the usual, you can get hematuria, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and granulocytopenia. Some hepatitis antivirals are just going to delay progression of liver disease. Don't discontinue them abruptly, or you can have some exacerbations of those symptoms. There's not really a cure. They are talking now that there may be a cure for Hep C, that they're working on. It's more prevalent that people will let you know than people with HIV. Our professor was talking about, like, usually the hospitals are like, let you know, like if somebody has hepatitis, you'll know that they have hepatitis, whereas somebody with HIV could come in and, you know, they won't call or inform you and you may not know about that. So these are going to inhibit viral replication. You're going to get like flu-like symptoms, depression, alopecia, that's hair loss, anorexia, dysgeusia, taste change, thyroid dysfunction, hepatotoxicity, renal impairment, and infection. Yet again, you're going to want to make sure you're taking fluids and watching your panels. Next, we're going to do some nursing process stuff. Aciclovir is the big one for herpes viruses, that medication. You're going to want to get their medical history for hepatic and renal disease, included. You want to eliminate or diminish the symptoms. Antifungals, you want to just make sure that they're working. Observe the side effects. Check for opportunistic infections and monitor CBCs. Now we're going to have some questions again. So go ahead and give yourself a 3-second break before we pause, and we're going to go over these questions real quick. Okay, so for the first one, C, hypoglycemia may occur within concurrent oral sulfonylureas. Question two, we're going to go with A, B, C, and D. The reason it's not E is because when we went over rifampin, it's an orange color and not a green color. Okay, question three is going to be B, because typically you are going to need 2 to 3 agents for this. And C is incorrect because it isn't resistant to therapy. Four, D, avoid the direct sunlight. Five, D, niastatin is the answer for that one. Question six, hypokalemia is going to be what you're going to be assessing for. And question seven is promote hydration. Like I said, renal function is a big part of this. You want to keep promoting hydration. So keep that in mind. Now we're on to the last little bit here, probably about 11 slides or so. So we're on to malaria. It's a protozoan disease. 10 to 35 days is its incubation period. Vivax is the most prevalent. Falciparum is the most severe case. So Falce is the worst, and Vivax is the most prevalent. So it has a tissue phase where it invades you, and there's not really a lot of symptoms. But then it has the erythrocytic phase where it starts invading your RBCs and you start getting those symptoms like fever, chills, sweating, and flu-like things. Anybody that may have malaria, you need travel info. It's good to acquire travel info for anybody with like flu-like symptoms or these similar symptoms, because maybe they've been to an area that has prevalence of malaria and you want to make sure that you can get onto that. So for anti-malarial drugs, queen, Q-U-I-N-E, will be the suffix that you're looking for here. So sometimes you'll do prophylaxis, so you'll like pre-treat people that are going to places that have those prevalences. Some side effects of these drugs, aside from the standard ones, are going to be like seizures and confusion, psychosis, ototoxicity, and possibly some eighth cranial nerve damage, some anemia, cardiovascular issues. So for assessment, like I said, make sure you find out whether or not they've traveled outside of the country, get a good patient history, and when they took, whether or not they took anti-malarial drugs when they did travel. You're going to plan for them to use these drugs and to take them appropriately. Some interventions, renal and liver function, you're going to watch that output and the panels. Monitor for impaired consciousness, seizures, and headaches. And definitely look for anybody returning from those areas. Like I said, you want to be definitely on top of that. So now we're on to helminths, or parasitic worms. You have tapeworms, flukes, roundworms, tissue worms. They're typically going to infect the intestinal areas where they're going to aim for. You're going to get these from entry from infected soils into the humans, typically through food, bites, direct penetration. They can also infect the lymphatic blood vessels in the liver, but they're mainly going to be in your intestines. So the anti-helminthic drugs are just basically going to destroy the worms, basically what we want. So like, destroying worms in my body, dude? Hell yeah. Yeah, hell yeah. Sorry, I like that meme. But so usually you're going to take these for 1 to 3 days. So they're pretty fast acting. The weirdest symptoms you're going to get with these, ocular opacity, abdominal discomfort, and a little bit of anal itching probably.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but can you go out through the lab, or are you almost done, or?
Yeah, you need me to leave now.
Whenever you're, like, I just need to, like, know in about time.
Yeah,
I know about how long you'll be.
Probably leave in, like, 15, 20 minutes, probably. Is that okay?
Do you mind going out upstairs?
Yeah, I can do that.
Do you mind relocating to the lab?
Yeah, is the lab open?
It is open, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That way I, because I'm the only one left.
Sorry about that, guys. Did a little bit of relocating. So where was I at? So, assess the patient for complaints of anal itching. Like I said, that's going to be a big sign that they may have that. See if they've traveled to other countries, because there's higher risk in some of those areas. Make sure your patient just washes their hands, honestly. Like, good hygiene is going to go a long way for this. Peptides are next. They're going to interfere with bacterial cell wall and cause cell death. So, like we went over, protection, it's going to get it killed. So, there's some antivirals, antimicrobials, antifungals, and antiparasitics for peptides. So, colicithamate is going to be for like Shigella, polymyxins for like E. coli, baxitration for like cuts. Those are going to treat mostly gram positive, a little bit of gram negative for those of you that are curious what type it's going for. Metronidazole is going to go for C. diff. Keep that in mind. Some side effects, other than the usual, probably some slurred speech, pruritus, seizures, ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and for the ones other than the metro, C. diff is an associated effect. So now we're going to go on to the questions, and that's going to wrap up today's part of that, and then I'm going to go straight into the review for you guys, and then I'll be done. So here you go. Question one, the answer is going to be B, because like we went over, the queen drugs are going to affect some hearing. There's going to be some ototoxicity occurring there. Question two, D, take prophylactics. Like I said, if you're going somewhere, you want to make sure that you're prepared if it's common there. Be aware of drowsiness for the antihelminths. The other ones kind of just don't make sense. You're going to want to take your medication after meals. That's a side one. I didn't really go over that, but make sure you take your medication after meals. Taking a bath is kind of gross when you have that type of thing, because you're kind of just soaking in it and you're letting it spread around your body. Definitely shower for the better option there. Change your sheets every day, not every other day. So for question four, that's going to be GI. Is going to be the big one there, because like I said, metro's C. diff. Alright, so I'm going to go into the review next. That's it for this week, guys. Alright, guys, so we're going on to a Pharm review. This is a study guide that was getting passed around for those of you that did acquire it. for those of you that didn't, I'm just going to go over it really quick. By really quick, you know, these sections probably take about 20 to 30 minutes. But it's about 18 pages, so I'll try to take some time with it, and we'll see where we go. So there's penicillins are going to be a main one we're going to focus on here to start off. So it's an antibiotic. It's bactericidal, so it kills. Mechanism of action, it's going to inhibit the cell wall, alter membrane permeability, protein synthesis, synthesis of bacterial RNA and DNA, interfere with metabolism of the cell. Basically, it's just going to interfere with any way that the cell can function. Beta-lactam structures are going to interfere with bacterial cell wall synthesis by inhibiting the enzymes that are necessary for cell division. We did go over some of those beta-lactam structure drugs, penicillin and cephalosporins. So you want to evaluate lab results, especially liver enzymes. Record their urine output. You want about 30 mils per hour. If you do an 8-hour check, about 240. If you're allergic to penicillin, you're probably going to be allergic to cephalosporins, like I said, because of those beta-lactam structures are very similar. So definitely watch out for that. Culture and sensitivity before you start. You want to know what you're treating so you can treat it appropriately. Always stay aware of opportunistic infections. Be aware for allergic reactions around the first and second dose. Assess for signs of bleeding when you get to really high doses because of platelet aggregation. Make sure you dilute if you're going IV route. Make sure you definitely enforce that your patient takes this medication all the way through. Like I said, antibiotics are very important to follow the full regimen, so that you don't create new infections. They should probably have a bracelet if they're allergic. Encourage fluid intake to aid in excretion. Female patients should be educated that you may have to take extra contraceptive because it can affect that. Take your medication with a little bit of food to avoid some GI stress. Most common side effects would be nausea, vomit, diarrhea, the typicals. Adverse reactions, severe allergic reaction or a super infection, which is the opportunistic stuff. Therapeutic levels are basically just ranges where things are effective. So you definitely want to make sure that you stay within a therapeutic range, and that's why we're always checking to make sure that patients fall within their therapeutic range for their medications. We don't have any listed on this study guide, so I can't really go over that with you. But definitely just know that if there's a question about a therapeutic range, it'll probably be presented to you, or it'll be one that you've gone over in your class or our class, and you'll be able to understand that if it's not within that range, it's not really going to be an effective drug. So next we're going to do sulfamethoxazole trimethoprim, or Bactrim and Septra. So these are sulfonamides, bacteriostatic, they're synergistic. So they'll interfere with bacterial folic acid, UTI is what they kind of combat. Use these to treat urinary, intestinal, and lower respiratory tract infections, and gonorrhea. Assess renal function, your BUN levels, serum creatines, get your medication histories. It's contraindicated if they have severe renal or liver disease. Assess for allergies. If your patient's on an anticoagulant like warfarin, this can really increase that effect, so definitely watch out for that. Watch your CBCs. Give medications with a full glass of water. Like I said, if you're watching liver and kidney functions, you're going to want to make sure extra fluid is in there, specifically for these, because you want to avoid crystallurea and kidney stones. Keep track of your eyes and nose, at least 2,000 milliliters in and at least out about 1,200. Watch your vitals, check your CBCs, watch for opportunistic infections. No sulfamides can be taken during the third trimester. Avoid antacids, like I said earlier, you know, 2 and 2, 2 hours before, 2 hours after. If you're allergic to one type, you're probably allergic to most types. And you want to take these roughly an hour before or 2 hours after a meal with a full glass of water. There's the typical side effects. The adverse ones we're going to look for are agranulocytes, specifically in leukocytes, aplastic anemia, and allergic myocarditis. Next we have amoxicillin, clavulante, augmentin. This is a type of penicillin, beta-lactamase inhibitor, and it's bactericidal. So amoxicillin is very broad spectrum, and when it's combined with these types of enzymes, when it's combined with the clavulanic acid, it's going to inhibit the beta-lactamases. So it's going to be very effective and extend its antimicrobial effects when they're combined together. Like I said, lab results, urine output, renal function, penicillin and cephalosporins, same allergies. CNSs, observe signs for allergic reactions, excess for bleeding. Take the full dose. Watch for allergic reactions. Next, we're going to go on to minocycline or mionicin. It's an antibiotic, tetracycline, long-acting. It's bacteriostatic. So like we've gone over earlier, cytal kills, static just prevents from getting worse. Inhibit bacterial protein synthesis is going to be the mechanism we're going to go under for this one. Vitals and urine output, lab values, history of dietary intake, obtain your samples, monitor lab values, store away from light and heat, check your expiration dates, avoid tetracyclines if you're planning to get pregnant or you are pregnant. If you're 8 or under, you shouldn't be taking this because it can cause permanent discoloration of the teeth. Take the entire course of the medication, avoid milk, iron, and antacids. If you do get the GI upset, you can take it with some non-dairy foods. Oral contraceptives and penicillins can be decreased when you're on a tetracycline, so definitely be aware that you might have to get a secondary contraceptive, or maybe take a stronger type of penicillin and work on your dosing there. There's going to be some photosensitivity, inner ear damage. It can mess with your balance, nephrotoxicity. So some treatments for mycotic infections or antifungals. So you're going to have pollens, azoles, anti-metabolites, echinocandins, and anti-protozoals. So those are some things you need to look out for mycotics. I'll go over that one more time. Pollens, azoles, anti-metabolites, echinocandins, and anti-protozoals. Those are going to be your things for your mycotic infections. So streptomycin is an anti-TB drug. It's usually a first-line drug. It can be used in various combinations. It occurs probably in that first initial phase, which is the 2 months, and then you'll continue with it as well as the other combination drugs up to 3 to 5 for the final 4 to 7 months of treatment. Like I went over, if you go with just one drug, it could take up to 2 years to cure TB. So we do this combination therapy at 3 to 5 to get rid of that in a quicker time frame. So for TB, you want history. Have they come into contact with it? Watch their liver enzymes, bilirubin, bond creatine. Signs and symptoms for peripheral neuropathy. It can affect your hearing. Streptomycin can affect hearing, so definitely watch out for that. That's probably a key thing to remember. Like I did say earlier in the video, if you've come into contact with TB and you've had it, you're going to need a chest x-ray to confirm or deconfirm, because the skin test is no longer going to be an accurate determination if you have the infection congruently. So you want to monitor toxicity. You want to get early AM sputum. So that's the hacking up type thing. Usually you'll get about 3 consecutive morning specimens sent to a lab. You always want to comply with this. TB is a very serious thing. 1 to 2 hours before or after meals for better absorption. Take it as prescribed. Avoid antacids and alcohol. The antacids are going to affect your drug absorption, and the alcohol is going to cause hepatic toxicity. You have standard side effects, headaches, dyscrasias, parathesia, GI distress, but some adverse ones you might have are hepatotoxicity, ototoxicity, optic nerve toxicity, encephalopathy, angioedema, CNS and respiratory depression, and some nephrotoxicity. So next we're on to Valtrex or valacyclovir, which is an antiviral synthetic purine nucleoside. It's going to interfere with DNA synthesis. It offers a greater decrease in pain and increase in healing time for herpes zoster. Watch for allergies. Do tissue cultures before you give the first dose so that you know what you're dealing with, which one. Get your med history, HIV infections, bone marrow, and renal transplants. Any impairments that they may have, monitor their levels, evaluate them very well. Sorry, I had to take a break real quick. Anyway, so back to where I was. Nursing interventions, the standard, you're going to measure their levels, analgesics for comfort, adequate fluid intake, encourage them to take the full thing, avoid touch on lesions for spreading. It doesn't cure herpes, it just treats the symptoms. Increase water take, intake, like I said, anything with renal or hepatic functions, you're going to want to definitely increase your fluids. It has the standard side effects. There's none that are severe listed, so probably just the allergic reactions are what you're going to want to watch out for. Next we have vancomycin. Everybody knows that this is basically what you treat C. diff with. Mainly, they're going against gram-positive, Staph aureus, cardiac, surgical prophylaxis. So Avoid other ototoxic and nephrotic medications, culture and sensitivity tests, obviously. Peak and trough levels. Peak levels are always going to be taken right after the medication. Trough levels are right before, because you want to make sure what the highest level they have and what the lowest level they'll have. Monitor BP. Severe hypertension can be prevalent if you don't monitor the dose appropriately, so be wary of that. Renal function and hearing are something that you need to watch out for. Definitely some superinfections. Make sure they take the full medication and report any ringing in the ears, hearing loss, or changes in their urinary patterns. Pretty standard side effects: chills, dizziness, fever, rash. Adverses are nephro-odo toxicity. There's red man syndrome, and that's from too rapid of an IV injection. You'll get very red, blotchy skin. That's a very toxic reaction. You can get blood dyscrasias and Stevens-Johnson's, with his very, it's a severe skin reaction, and it looks really gross. It looks like your skin's melting off, basically. Look it up if you don't know what it is. It's kind of gross. Fibromycin, or doxycycline, is an antibiotic. It's tetracycline, long-acting. It can be bacteriostatic or bactericidal, depending on your dose. It inhibits protein synthesis. It's for gram-positive and gram-negatives. Skin infections, chlamydia, gonorrhea, syphilis, rickets, history, allergies, lab values, dietary intake, assess vitals and urine. Keep out for allergic reactions that you might see. Watch level of consciousness, because it can alter intracranial pressure. CBCs, 1 hour before, 2 hours after meals. Watch out for opportunistic infections. Store away from heat. Check your expiration dates. It's tetracycline. Don't give it to pregnant people. Don't give it to kids for teeth staining. Avoid milk, iron, and acids. Oral contraceptives and penicillins, as we know. You're going to want to watch your doses, because they're going to be less effective because of these. Pretty standard common side effects. They may have photosensitivity or teeth discoloration. Adverse reactions can be hepatotoxicity, the intracranial hypertension I was speaking of, pseudomembranous colitis, blood dyscrasia, Stevens-Johnson's. Next we have gentamicin, antibacterial, aminoglycoside, bactericidal. Inhibits protein synth. Do some careful monitoring of your serum levels to avoid adverse reactions. Pretty standard hearing loss, tinnitus, muscle cramps, weakness, photosensitivity, nausea, vomiting, rash. Your big ones are going to be your hearing ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, peripheral neuropathy, laryngeal edema, thrombocytopenia, agranulocytosis, and some liver damage. Tetracyclines are on here again. We know that, as I've said multiple times, it's for bacterial protein synthesis. Watch your lab values. Non-pregnant women, kids under 8, hepatotoxicity and blood dyscrasias. Onto an anti-tubercular first-line drug. It's bactericidal. It's sonaizid. It's the INH. It's not INH for inhalation. It's only oral and intramuscular, I believe. It breaks down the cell wall synthesis. Get your history. You need to know if they've come into contact. You need to watch if you're coming into contact with somebody with TB. Collect sputum in the morning. That's from down here. Give vitamin B6 or pyridoxine to prevent the neuropathy. Watch the liver enzymes. Encourage eye exams on this drug for visual disturbances. Report numbing, tingling, burning. Avoid direct sunlight. Typical side effects: photosensitivity, tinnitus as well. Adverse reactions, the big ones, is the peripheral neuropathy. You're going to take that vitamin to help get rid of that. Psychotic behavior, a B6 deficiency, blood dyscrasias, the hepatotoxicity, and some seizures. Next, we have flagyl or metronidazole. This impairs DNA function. Used to treat various disorders in the GI, anaerobic infections, bacterial vaginosis, pre-op prophylaxis. Avoid alcohol for 48 hours because you can get a disulfiram reaction, which can be facial flushing, sweating, severe headache, slurred speech, tachycardia, palpitations, hypertension. If you're taking high doses, may experience dark or red brown urine. Make sure that your patient is aware of this so that they're not freaking out or quitting. You want to avoid this during the first trimester of pregnancy. Pretty common side effects, dry mouth, weakness, the usual metallic or a bitter taste, GI. Chloroquine or Aralen, A-R-A-L-E-N, this is an anti-malarial. It increases the pH in the malaria parasite, inhibits parasitic growth. So, like I said, when you go with anybody that may have had malaria because they've come in to these weird regions, so you're going to want to make sure that you're watching hearing, and because of the nerve damage that could come to the eighth nerve, so definitely watch for hearing in any of the quins. Check for visual changes, renal and liver function. Educate, make sure they know the signs and symptoms of malaria, any vision changes they may have. Avoid large consumption of alcohol. Pretty standard side effects, visual impairment, and photosensitivity are the big ones there. Adverse reactions are hypotension, psychosis, seizures, blood dyscrasias, ototoxicity, and cardiovascular collapse. So that can get pretty serious. The anti-helmetics, like I said, 1 to 3 days. These are going to kill the parasites. What have they eaten? Do they have anal itching? What are the baseline vitals and collect a stool specimen? Daily showers, no baths. Constantly wash your hands, practice good hygiene. Finish the whole medication. You may get drowsy and report any other side effects. Drowsiness is the big one, and there's rarely any adverse because it's such a short time you're on it. Acyclovir or Zovirax is an antiviral. It's a synthetic purine nucleoside. Interferes with viral synthesis of DNA. This is one of the ones that's going to go up against herpes. So you want to get their baseline vitals and CBCs, labs, urine output, because it can affect renal function. Monitor their vitals because it can cause orthostatic hypertension. Watch out for opportunistic infections. It's administered over 60 minutes, never bolus. So 60 minutes for acyclovir. Encourage oral hygiene. Instruct patients with genital herpes to avoid sexual activity or use condoms. Well, they should use condoms, but to avoid sexual activity is basically the best way to get away from that, because nothing's 100%, as we all know. Get adequate fluid intake because, you know, some renal issues you're going to have. Common side effects are going to have bleeding time and then the typical things, lethargia, headache, and stuff. Adverse reactions are going to be like anemia, crystallurea, neuropathy, seizures, nephrotox, and blood dyscrasias. Fluconazole or Diflucan is an antifungal. It's an azole. Like I said, azoles are going to be your fungals. Increases that permeability of that cell membrane. It's contraindicated in people with renal or hepatic diseases. Watch their lab values. Record their baselines. take the full medication, avoid alcohol, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea if it's a large dose, stomach cramps, rash, headaches. TB treatment. So, prophylactic therapy is suggested if you've come into contact with somebody with TB. People who have HIV or anybody who has a positive TB skin test. Like I said, single drug therapy is not good. We're going to run 3 to 5 to reduce that from 2 years to 6 to 9 months. First phase is 2 months. Second phase is 4 to 7 months after that. Rifampin is going to give you about some orangey colored secretions like your sweat, your urine. You're going to be on about one to two drugs for the first 2 months, and then they're going to increase to that 3 to 5 at the end. Super infections are just going to be infections that come in whenever you're reduced your normal flora or you've become immunosuppressed. Just things that are going to capitalize on your weakness here. Antivirals for the flu should be started within 48 hours of onset of symptoms for them to be effective. Red man syndrome is toxic, red blotching of the skin. So bacterial resistance can occur naturally. It could be acquired from prior exposure. Antibiotic resistance can occur when antibiotics are used too frequently. Like I said, if you're using antibiotics inappropriately, you're going to create the bacteria to have resistance to that, and that can cause more issues for treatment. So it can also occur, you know, naturally if it just mutates, but don't speed that up yourself. Broad spectrum antibiotics are going to be antibiotics that can treat both gram positive and gram negative. So we went over the 5 generations of cephalosporins. So I got the 1, 2, 3, 4 right here. 4 and 5 are basically the same, but I'll go over them really quick here. So first generation is going to be gram positive and some gram negative. Second is going to be more gram negatives. Third is going to be effective against both, purely both. Fourth is going to be fully resistant to most beta-lactamase bacteria as well, and broad coverage. And then 5 is going to be a very resistant to the beta-lactamase bacteria. That's about all I got, guys, on this study review, and I hope that it helped. I hope I didn't go too fast, but it is in a video form now, so you guys can rewind, replay, hear what I said. Go ahead and send any questions if you have them. I'll have the questions below in the box. And hopefully if you guys send some comments or something, I might be able to help out. Maybe I said something wrong, you can catch me. We can get this out so we get a better form of education for other people. Deuces, guys. Catch you next week. Bevel up.